Welcome to Tampa, Florida. You're watching ESPNU College Football Primetime presented by Citi. And tonight it's a Big East showdown. The Bulls of South Florida and the Cardinals of Louisville. When you look at the Big East standing, these two teams not where they wanted to be at this juncture of the season, with UConn and West Virginia seemingly playing for that title next week. Well, hi again, everyone. I'm Dave Armstrong. When you look at these two teams here tonight, it's amazing how similar they really are. Both have risen to national prominence, but both have also suffered some devastating losses. When you look at their seasons this year, Louisville, they start off in the top 10. Many thought they could play for a national title this year, but then early losses to both Kentucky and then Syracuse, and five losses overall have really derailed the Cardinals. As far as USF is concerned, they had that unbelievable run where they started 6-0, ranked as high as number 2 in the country, but then three losses in a row, and now they're not even ranked. And joining me now, as always, is the coach, Mike Gottfried. Mike, still a lot to play for these two teams.
Should be a great football game tonight. Louisville trying to get in the mix for the bowl games. South Florida trying to move uptown.
Well, when you look at Louisville, one of the reasons they're even a possibility of becoming bowl eligible tonight is one of the best quarterbacks in the country in Brian Brohm.
I think he is the best quarterback in the country. Brian Brohm's a strong arm drop back passer, doesn't have the benefit of good running yet, so he has to make plays for this Louisville offensive football team.
He's a traditional drop back quarterback, a contrast in styles. South Florida's quarterback, he's good as well, but he's a dual threat in Matt Grothy.
Yeah, Matt Grothy is a tough quarterback. He runs the football, dual threat, he can throw it, and they need him to have a big ball game tonight to keep the ball away from Brian Brohm, keep that offense on the sideline.
If you like offense, you have come to the right place. Jim Leavitt's team, they're all about offense. Will it be easy, though? Nothing's easy. Louisville in South Florida, and the kickoff is next. More than 50,000 expected here tonight at Raymond James Stadium in Tampa, Florida, for Louisville in South Florida. And now with more on this budding rivalry, let's go down on the field to our third member of our team, Melissa Knowles.
Thanks, Dave. You know, people are expecting tonight's game to be a real shootout that will come down to a fourth quarter barn burner. I spoke with Coach Leavitt earlier in the week, and he told me that he's expecting tonight to be electric and exciting. But throughout the week, he told his players that they really need to put those losses behind them and to focus on the matchup tonight. Now, on the other side of the ball, Coach Steve Kragthorpe told me that he's expecting it to be a big, noisy crowd and a very hostile environment. But what it comes down to for his players is attitude and focus and effort. Now, Louisville has had 9 consecutive bowl trips, but if they don't win tonight, that 9-year streak could be over. Dave?
Thanks a lot, Melissa. Well, it should be a shootout, as Melissa pointed to. They're going through the coin toss now. These two teams, members of the Big East, they haven't been members long, only their 5th meeting between the two. The home team has won every game. And coach, it was 2 years ago here that really helped put South Florida on the map when they upset Louisville in that game.
It was a big ball game, and you're right, Dave. That may have been the start. They beat Pittsburgh a couple years before that, but this was a big win for the South Florida program.
Well, it certainly was. We talked to Jim Leavitt yesterday, and he mentioned that Pittsburgh game a few years before that. Says, you know, here we are, this upstart program. We're literally no program at all 11 years ago. We've only been in Division I since the start of this century. And then we go to Pittsburgh, a place that's won 6 national championships, and we win there. And he said that, in his mind, put him on the map. But nationally, that win against Louisville here, that's what got everyone's attention.
I don't doubt you, because I think any time you can beat the Louisville football program, it's a big win. And tonight, Dave, I expect that the special teams in the kicking game is going to be a big part of who wins this football game tonight, because South Florida has so much speed on their kick teams.
They've even got speed at the coach. I mean, Leavitt's out there running sprints before the game.
He is. He's in pretty good shape, too. Can't run with these guys.
Well, that'll be South Florida to kick off. And back deep to get it for Louisville. Trent Guy standing at his own 2-yard line. Guy, you look at him, 29 returns, an average of just over 23. Gilbert Alvarado, who both does the punting chores and the kicking chores to kick things off. And here we go. We're underway from Tampa. High end over end kick. Guy's got it at the 5. Stopped at the 20. Drops the ball. It's still loose. Louisville is going to lose the ball, and South Florida scores the touchdown. Wow, what a beginning for the Bulls. Jerome Murphy. Nate Allen got in on the play, and Allen able to cover this up.
Trent Guy with the return, the helmet right on the football, caused a fumble. And if you're Louisville on the road, this is the worst possible way you could start a football game.
Murphy, the one that knocked it loose. Love, the one that scored. Or excuse me, Allen, the one that scored. The point after, no good. So a miss for Alvarado, but boy, an electric start for the Bulls.
Dave, I talked about special teams in the kicking game tonight because there's so much speed on the field. Allen just grabs this football, alertly gets in the end zone. A tough way to start, but the missed extra points big also. Trent Guy, as he comes, he just didn't tuck the football away. Allen had a good bounce, almost like a shortstop in baseball.
Guys that work in that secondary for the Bulls defense, they get this crowd right into this game right from the get-go as Allen scores when Murphy knocked it loose.
Steve Kragthorpe, he'll get his offense and defense together and say, hey, we're spotting them 6, but we're all right.
Yeah, but that's like giving Tiger Woods 3 before you ever get started.
Well, when you have Brian Bromo,
that's true.
You know, you're going to score points, so it's early in this contest.
Yeah, Brom is, in golf terms, Brom's a birdie machine.
I don't know anything about golf, but he is football. He's a scoring machine.
That's right. Same thing. So now Harry Douglas is back there. They've already made a change. Trent Guy out. One drop and boom, they're done. And now we've got a flag coming in.
Jim Leavitt is on the field. Now what you'd like to do if you're Louisville, you'd like to get a big return and set up your quarterback, Brian Brown.
So the delay of game cost him 5 yards. Fumble on the kickoff, taken in for the touchdown by Allen. Already at 6-0. So Harry Douglas back now at his own 8-yard line. High end over end kick. Douglas, he'll have it at the 10. He breaks to the outside, or tries to, and then smothered at the 25-yard line by Edner Alson. Only a 16-yard return. What a hit.
Harry Douglas, they had a left return on, and he's not used to be back there because he started to the left and thought his speed would outrun the South Florida coverage, but he made a mistake going back to the right side.
Well, here's a closer look at the best quarterback. I agree with you, Coach. In the land, 67%. Certainly the best pure dropback quarterback in the land. He's going to set a Big East record here tonight, no doubt. He only needs 60 yards passing to have a new career mark in the Big East. He'll pass Ken Dorsey. There's a pickup to the 30-yard line, a gain of 4. But Brian Brom, this guy, they've got him projected as the number 6 pick in next year's NFL draft. He came back for his senior year. He is a special, special player.
The best quarterback in the country, I think, right now, passing quarterback for the NFL. I expect he's going to take his team right down the field against this South Florida defense. He's a talent.
2nd and 6. Brom throwing on the run, and he throws a strike. Oh, that could be a late hit. out of bounds. Boy, that was a big hit anyway. Douglas, and then Jenkins really stuck him.
If you're going to have a hit like that, don't do it on the Louisville sideline, because every coach on that sideline, every player is going to say they're going to call for that hit penalty. Jenkins, who's one of the best, if not the best corner in college football, just couldn't stop that. That's close right here, but he's on the sideline, but that's a penalty.
So Jenkins with a personal foul there, and all of a sudden, Brohm and the Cardinals are in South Florida territory at the 43. Beaumont, the man in motion. No running room here for Boland. Well, let's check out Louisville offensively, the backs and receivers. You can pretty well throw out the running game. They haven't been able to do it this year. Douglas is back. He missed a couple of games. He is special. And Barnage is a go-to guy at tight end. When you look at that offensive line, the man that you really have to focus on is the left tackle, George Bussey, because he's going to have to try somehow to keep George Selby out of the backfield. Little jump. Selby got anxious. So now I see he's got 14 and a half sacks.
Prior to the snap, false start. Number 63 off there. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
But that was Barlow's fault.
Yeah, Dave, you talked about the running game or lack of for Steve Kragthorpe's
right.
football team. That means everything. The weight of this offensive football team is on the quarterback, Brian Brohm. He has to make plays.
Fortunately for Louisville, he can. Quick drop. Strike again, right on target, again to Douglas. This one down to the 39-yard line, a gain of 10. All right, here is South Florida defensively. The one man you really got to keep your eyes on is George Selby. He has 14 and a half sacks this year and more than 30 tackles for loss. The linebackers are all good. They're all averaging about 8 tackles per game, led by senior Ben Moffitt. Tyrone McKenzie is a transfer from Iowa State. And the secondary, very good. 16 interceptions for the secondary. They can pick you.
And third down is big for South Florida. They're going to win this game. They got to be good on third down.
Carter goes in motion. Brohm given time, and his pass off the hands of Mario Yerudia. He had a little bit of room to run and would have had the first down.
Yerudia and Douglas both missed about 2.5 games this year, and really with the injuries. Yerudia had a foot injury, and timing's not exactly there.
Corey Getchy on to punt now. Try to pooch one down there. And pin South Florida inside the 20. He does pooch it down, and it is caught at the 14-yard line. Only a 25-yard punt caught by Marcus Edwards there on a fair catch. So now Matt Grothy comes out. Different quarterback, isn't he, Coach?
He really is. He can hurt you running the football and throwing the football. The one thing he's been prone to do is throw interceptions. He has 11 TD passes this year, 11 interceptions.
Now, didn't you promise us at the meeting today that if he had a big game, you'd get a mohawk?
No.
Oh, I thought
have enough hair.
Handoff and a big hole. Wow. Lots of room to run for Mike Ford, a freshman transfer from Alabama. Mike Ford, what a journey for this kid. And that time he carries it 43 yards.
Dave, I was on the field before the game and I looked at Mike Ford. He is a 225-pound running back, a tough guy. I think he's going to be a star here in the future.
Here are the numbers on Ford. This kid has had quite a journey. He's been all over. He's had to go to a JUCO. He didn't play there. He was going to redshirt there just to get his grades. Huge talent. and you can see the talent. Big guy, 6'2", 225. He's a bruiser, but he can also run with authority. His dad, Robert, is a maintenance guy here at South Florida.
He is just a very good running back, but the holes that the offensive line in two plays have opened up this Louisville defense and knocked them back.
That has been the problem for the Cardinals all season long, their defense. They've given up over 400 yards total offense per game and more than 28 points per game. That's why they have five losses. Grothy dancing around, bought himself some time, and a pass complete. The pass is completed to the outside. Yes, he's able to get it to Cedric Hill. Here are the backs and receivers for South Florida. Benjamin Williams will play along with Mike Ford, who started tonight. Mitchell, Johnson, Edwards, Hill all can catch the ball. Also, you have to watch out for Grothy as a runner. The offensive line, very good. Only one senior on this entire offense, and that is Jared Carnes. Gain of five, second and five of the 15. Whistle will blow this play dead.
Charge timeout, South Florida. That is the first charge timeout of the half.
That timeout came from the sideline.
Yeah, Jim Leavitt didn't like something he saw, the way they lined up or the personnel he had at the football game.
So we'll break with him. Tampa, a good start for South Florida. They take that opening kick and take it in for a touchdown. Welcome back to Raymond James Stadium in Tampa, Florida, with South Florida already leading 6-0 and knocking on the door again. They're at the 15-yard line where it's second and five for Matt Grothy and company. So Grothy, just a sophomore. One of the things that is a problem for Grothy this year, turnovers. He has 11 touchdown passes, but also 11 interceptions. He knows it. He's been working on it. Play action pass. Grothy throws on the run, and the pass is complete. He's able to get it out to Torres Johnson, very good receiver, a junior out of Cape Coral.
We talked about Matt Grothy, not only 11 TD passes, 11 interceptions this year, 26 career TDs, but 25 career interceptions. So he does make mistakes, but he's young. He's only sophomore.
Ball just out the side of the six. This will be an easy touchdown. Wow. Why not? Ford carried him that far. Why not take it in? His ninth touchdown run of the year, and he made it look easy. So Mike Ford, the freshman. I told you his dad works in the maintenance department here. We'll tell you more of that story in a second. Coach, a nice run there for Mike Ford as he's able to take it into the end zone. Ford's dad was a collegiate wrestler, but they discovered when he was in his 40s that he really was a functional illiterate. And some of the people on the maintenance crew, they said, well, you know what, we're going to get together and teach this guy how to read. Well, like father, like son, Mike Ford, he struggled with that as well. It was tough for him coming out of Sarasota to get his grades right. He had committed to Alabama, couldn't get eligible there, went to a JUCO, and now winds up here at South Florida with his dad, and boy, nothing could have worked out better.
What a great cutback, too. You look, see the vision, opens up backside, and he takes it in for the score. You have to wonder about Louisville right now, their psyche.
Yes.
Because they need this football game, because even if they win next week, six wins, they're eligible for a bowl, but
right,
there's only five spots, and there's going to be six teams. And now, and Louisville, with only six wins, they're in trouble, I believe. They need this football game.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, there are so many teams out there, Coach, BCS teams, that will have six wins. So you're really leaving it up to the discretion of some of those selection committees. Seven is a much safer number. And for Louisville to get there, they have to win both tonight and next week at home against Rutgers. Here comes Douglas again. This time he knows his right from his left. And a good thing, as Douglas gets it past midfield, he is skirting the sideline. They say he is out of bounds, out of bounds.
Harry Douglas, he's an explosive receiver. You were right, Dave. He stayed down the left side here.
That's a big run back here. That's Powell, actually, with the ball. It's Powell. So they're trying everybody back there. Powell
Why
with
not?
His first return of the year. And you know what? He might get another chance.
No, he looked very good. Powell, explosive. Jim Levin pointed out that he
right.
stepped out of bounds.
And he did, because that was reviewed, like every play is. Nice quick hitter. Urrutia has got it. Close to a first down. We'll see where they mark it. Looks like he will have enough for the first down. A gain of 11. And they'll move the chains.
Louisville was down 31-14 to West Virginia. Came back and tied that football game. Then Pat White scored a TD and put it out of reach. But Louisville can score and can score quickly.
A little running attack, a little change of pace. That's the first run for Anthony Allen. He's able to gain about two or three on first down.
Brian Brown, 7 games this year, 35-plus pass attempts, none last year. Now, the reason for that is they cannot run the football this year. They ran it last year. When you have the run, it draws the zone plays, it traps. You invite the rush up, and then you take care of it. But without the run, you have to control the pass rush with short passes.
Good quick hitter here to Douglas. He gets it down to the 20-yard line. And I think, Coach, that's what makes Brom even more special, the fact that he doesn't have a running attack, the fact that he's still able to hit 67% of his passes.
Without a running game, you're going to play nickel in there against them, dime, which is 60 DBs. Your pass rushers are going to work up the field. It's tough.
Had great numbers last week. But it wasn't enough against West Virginia as Louisville fell 38-31. And they try to run, nothing doing here for Allen. He is stopped right at the line of scrimmage. Selby was in on the hit.
Anthony Allen's got to get hot. He's coming back home. He played here at Tampa Jesuit High School. He has to be able to run the football if they're going to win this game.
Allen averaging just 67 yards per game. He had a huge game earlier this year against Middle Tennessee State. He rushed for 275 yards in that game. Brom forced out of the pocket. Tough throw. In fact, he just throws it away. He's outside the tackles. As we get our first update from Lowell Galindo in the studio.
Thanks so much, Dave. We're going to start off with Cincinnati and West Virginia. Ben Mock getting points in a hurry here. 70 yards to Marcus Barnett. That ties the game up at 7. Cincinnati and West Virginia. And then Clemson and Boston College. James Davis, 1 yard off the direct snap. Clemson leading BC 7-0. Winner goes to the ACC title game.
Big games going on there between those four teams, ACC and Big East implications very strong. 3rd and 9. Pass is complete, but well shy of the first down. George Stripling with the catch, but he is hit immediately by Ben Moffitt.
Ben Moffitt, a very good tackle on the play. He's 2nd in tackles for the South Florida football team. I like the story about him. He commutes every day 110 miles back and forth to his home.
Married early, married right out of high school, already has 2 children. His wife helps support him, says she's my hero. But they tried living in Tampa his freshman year. It didn't work out. They're much more comfortable in their hometown of Bushnell, Florida. Field goal is good, 32 yards for Art Carmody, who's getting closer and closer to an NCAA record of his own. So Louisville gets some points, but they still trail by 10 at the 7:41 mark of the first quarter. ESPNU College Football Primetime is presented by Citi. Whatever your story is, your Citi card can help you write it. Citi, let's get it done. And by Clean Exchange, the only electric shaver with a disposable head. Clean Exchange, new from Remington. With Mike Gottfried and Melissa Knowles, Dave Armstrong at Raymond James Stadium in Tampa, Florida. South Florida leading 13-3. South Florida got that opening kickoff. A fumble by Trent Guy was picked up and returned for a touchdown for the Bulls. And they were able to punch in another score.
They better be good on kickoff coverage because South Florida can return the speed.
Murphy back. And this is Murphy starting at his 10. A little bit of a move, breaks outside. Murphy still on his feet. There is a flag down now. And now he loses the ball. The ball pops up again. It looks like Louisville is trying to recover it, and they do.
See if they got it in bounds.
I don't know. It's going to be close. That ball was squirting out of bounds. Remember, if Louisville's going to change possession on this kickoff, they would have had to have had possession before it goes out of bounds.
I think they got it.
But there is a flag on the play as well. Very well could be against South Florida.
During the return, illegal block in the back. Number 27 on the receiving team. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
See what happens here. A lot of missed tackles.
Again, Murphy, right here. Murphy, he just kind of a little lateral to Jenkins, and then he loses it.
Doesn't have time to put it away.
And that ball, then it goes out of bounds. That's what happens.
Couldn't get control. Now, Steve Kragthorpe, you got to be sitting at home saying Louisville was 12-1 last year, 14 starters back. What has happened for them to be a 5-5 football team? But I can tell you this. When you come into a program, and I'll finish it after this play.
So Florida lucky to have the ball at their own 10-yard line. There's Ford getting it up to the 15.
And, Dave, you start to address your football team. They were not recruited by you. All of a sudden, you come in and you tighten up issues, and you're demanding, and you discipline. And some guys are not going to fit. And Patrick Carter, the wide receiver, said, "Our chemistry is not as good this year as last year."
Nice little move by Williams. Boy, Williams could have been dropped for a loss. Instead, he gets it up to the 32-yard line. A huge gain there before Woody Terrain could bring him down. 17 yards on the play for Williams.
Williams should have got tackled in the backfield, a missed tackle, but it goes back to what I said. Team chemistry is so important.
Now back to Ford. And Ford with a gain up to the 33-yard line.
All this is going to do is help Matt Grothy throw the football, because once you establish the run with Mike Ford and the offensive line takes control, now your big plays come in the passing game.
Draw play, gain up to the 35-yard line. And Ford with yet another carry. Ford getting the lion's share of the work here. Ford, at the age of 5, went swimming out in the Gulf of Mexico, and he did not have a life preserver on. Thought it was just going to be a little fun out there, and next thing you know, he is unconscious. Bumps into a fisherman. Luckily, fisherman hauls him out of the water. They pumped his chest, did CPR on him, got all kinds of water out of his lungs. He thought he was going to die right there on the beach, and somehow he was able to live. There's the running ability of Matt Grothy. So Ford, he will tell you right now, he is lucky to still be on this earth.
And Mike Ford, like I said before, he's going to be a great tailback here for this football team. He made a key block on the last play to spring Matt Grothy.
Ford again. And this time, nothing doing. Maybe a yard. That's about it.
Mike Ford, early in this football game, has been the offense for South Florida. The offensive line's done a great job, especially on the right side. Jared Carnes and Zach Herman. But Ford has been off and running here in this football game.
Well, look at his numbers already, Coach. 7 rushes for 82 yards and a touchdown. Now an empty backfield here for Grothy. Of course, Grothy can run it himself. And he will. That is a design play, a quarterback draw, and Grothy is tumbled at the 28-yard line by Bobby Buchanan.
A lot of times when you have a quarterback like Matt Grothy and you play man coverage, watch the defensive backs, they're on man coverage. He tucks the ball. Now there's nobody in the middle of the field because they're running with their backs to the ball in man coverage.
31 yards there. Look at him on the year. He is the leading rusher for this team. Over 700 yards now. We'll continue to pile on that single season record for a quarterback. And another timeout taken here by Jim Leavitt. That's the second timeout called from the sideline. And the Bulls have only one timeout remaining this half.
Yeah, Jim Leavitt again saw something. Some personnel was not right in there for the play they were going to call. And he didn't want to take a bad play. He wanted to take a timeout, save the play.
Coach, you already said you don't know much about golf. We'll try basketball next. That's certainly coming up on the
about that.
Well, you coached at Kansas. You ought to know a little something about basketball. By the way, it continues tomorrow. A couple of games from the O'Reilly Auto Parts Puerto Rico tip-off at 11 a.m. Temple faces Marist in a seventh-place game. Then at 1 Eastern, the College of Charleston takes on Houston for fifth place. That's all tomorrow right here on the U.
Both good games. I'm going to take Marist and College of Charleston.
Really? All right.
Yeah, in upsets.
Okay, so you don't know what you're talking about there either. No, I'm just kidding. You're good. No, I think those are good picks.
College of Charleston is very good. And, I know John Chaney's not a Temple anymore.
No, that's good. Look at the numbers rushing. Of course, Louisville this year, they are 1-4 when they don't rush for over 100 yards. So that has been a big part. We often talk with the Cardinals about their defense, and that has been a big problem for Louisville this year, but it's also the lack of a running game that has hurt them. Grothy is spun down at the 23-yard line by LT Walker.
Yeah, both those things you talked about. You can't run the ball and you can't stop the other team.
Bad.
That's why you're 5-5.
Yeah.
Now, if you didn't have Brian Brown, you might be 2-8.
You might be Notre Dame.
No. No, they're better than Notre Dame.
Even without that, huh?
Even without all the parts.
That's the 10th play of this drive. Grothy on target. Good pass as he gets it to the outside. Pass is completed out there to Carlton Mitchell. A good-looking redshirt freshman.
Matt Grothy, the 2006 Big East Rookie of the Year. I saw him in the bowl game last year in Birmingham, Papa John's Bowl, and he did a great job in the win over East Carolina. Good bowl game last year.
Yeah, it was. Mitchell, by the way, needed only 19 yards coming into this game for a new freshman receiving record. Grothy on the keeper, and he'll go in for the score. His 9th rushing touchdown of the year.
When I watch that play, Dave, if I'm Steve Kragthorpe, I'm really upset with my defense. They did not get off blocks. They did not. Effort was not there. Matt Grothy should have been tackled about the 5-6 yard line. The effort is not there for the Louisville defense on that play.
14-yard touchdown for Grothy. South Florida making it look easy. This to give him a 17-point lead. So Grothy, who started a Mohawk trend in America, he's able to slice and dice his way into the end zone here. His ninth rushing touchdown of the year in South Florida, up by 17.
Poor job on defense by the Louisville defense. They didn't get off blocks on this play. Oh, Matt Grothy, you just watch. Poor angles, poor effort. I think I can't stress enough how poor that was. And if you're a coach, you really feel bad when the effort's out there. You don't mind mistakes. You don't mind getting beat by a better team. But when the effort's not there, you wonder about that.
That was an impressive drive for South Florida, Coach. 11 plays, almost 90 yards, capped by that Grothy 14-yard touchdown run. Grothy, by the way, with 4 rushes for 57 yards in this game. And here's one that'll stagger you, Coach. The Bulls are averaging almost 11 yards per play.
Track me.
High end over end kick taken in at the 14-yard line. And again, it's Bilal Paul as he takes it up to the 37-yard line. A return of 24. Let's go down to Melissa Knowles with more on Brian Brohm.
Just a minute ago when Brian Brohm and Harry Douglas were over here on the sideline, the two of them were talking. Now, I was about 10 feet away, and I'm not the best at reading lips, but I know I saw Brian Brohm say, if you get open, Harry Douglas, I will get the ball to you. We are still in this game. There is a lot of football to be played. Do not get down. Dave?
All right, they're going to need that combination here.
I can't read lips, and I can't see Brian Brohm down the field, but I can know he's telling them that.
Well, right away they go to that combination, but it goes right through the chest of Harry Douglas. Roberts was there on the coverage. I don't know if he tipped the ball and deflected it a little bit.
Here's a challenge for Louisville's offense tonight. They're playing against a very good defensive football team, especially in the secondary.
Looking at that, I don't think Roberts ever actually touched it, but he certainly impaired the vision.
He just got Harry Douglas's eyes off the ball.
Makes you flinch a little bit when you're a receiver. The pitch back. Yeah, not much room to run here. Again, they try to go to the outside. Tough for a big guy to go to the outside like that. And that's Powell again. Bilal Paul.
And Tyler Roberts just made a good effort to make that tackle. This game's fast getting away from Louisville. They need a score.
Well, they're 0 for 2 on third down and facing a 3rd and 8 here. They need to reach the 47 for a first down. Brohm throws a screen pass for Powell, but it's incomplete. I don't think he'd have had anywhere near the first down anyway.
South Florida played that well. Wally Burnham, the defensive coordinator, used to be at FSU with Bobby Bowden. Dan McCarney used to be the head coach at Iowa State, charge of the defensive line. They played this play excellent. Ben Moffitt was right there.
Coach, I got a question for you, a coaching question. As there are whistles out, this would be a good time to ask you. So far from Brohm, what we have seen are a lot of dump down passes, right, short passes. Is that in part because of the fear of George Selvey and what he can bring if you stand back in that pocket?
I think it's two-part answer. One, you got George Selby, and he's made so many sacks and tackles for the losses. But the secondary of South Florida is very good at covering the deep ball. So you have to open them up with the short passing game and then make that available to go deep later.
Officials sort out this last call. The whistle blew, and before the ball was snapped, so now they're all trying to get it squared away as to what the call is actually going to be. George Selby, so far no sacks in this game. He leads the NCAA. In fact, he has 14 and a half sacks. The entire Louisville team has 15.
There's no foul or illegal substitution. The late player coming onto the field was the 11th player. Fourth down.
So they get to punt it again for free. No extra charge on this.
No, you get to practice.
Corey Getchy's had too much practice punting so far in this game. This is a beauty. And it sends Edwards all the way back inside his own 15. Now pinned in. Good coverage as well as Selby ridden out of bounds at the 18-yard line. And that's where they'll come back on the attack again.
Something's got to happen in this football game. Either your defense, Louisville,
yep.
Talking about them, they have to stand up here because they've been gutted.
Well, that one kickoff, that was the opportunity for Louisville, but then they knocked the ball out of bounds. They couldn't recover that fumble on the kickoff.
And this is the kind of football game, if you're South Florida, you have to keep the pressure on Louisville because you know Brian Brown can unleash some scoring. So you have to keep putting pressure on this defense.
Well, they've certainly done that, as we mentioned, averaging almost 11 yards per play in this game. Grothy back to pass. Steps up, dumps it off. This one is completed. And that's the same guy, the return man, Edwards. Yes, he's able to get the ball all the way up. See where they mark it. They're going to mark that ball up to the 34-yard line.
That's Marcus Edwards' 15th reception. And Matt Grothy, a wide alert. Just started to run and saw Edwards open, dumped him the ball, big play.
Edwards, part of that South Florida attack that has made this a one-sided game in terms of total yards. Another pass completed. And everything is completed right now. This one to the tight end, Cedric Hill. And so Hill makes the grab, and that one comes all the way up for a gain of 9. So now just second and 1.
Here's what you got going. If you're Matt Grothy, you can run the ball with Ford. You can run it. The passing game's open. The short passing game. Everything's clicking.
Had to give the ball to Samuels. Excuse me. No, that's Williams. So Williams with the carry. Doesn't get much. In fact, he loses about a half yard. Makes it 3rd and 2.
That was a good job of the Louisville defensive front on the right side. Maurice Mitchell and Willie Williams got penetration and made a play.
Need to make another one here. Power formation. This will not be enough for the first down. Good stand here by Louisville. It's going to most likely force South Florida to punt the ball as Ford is drilled before he can get that first down.
That was a phone booth play where everybody was in tight in a phone booth. Nobody was moving. I think Jim Leavitt would like to add that call back.
Well, that takes us to the end of the first quarter. First quarter started great for South Florida and ended pretty well. Ford scores, Grothy scores, 3 touchdowns for South Florida to lead by 17.
If we're running a gap block play like, say, 24-27.
Well, they're talking to that offensive line about that last play that did not work, and South Florida's going to have to punt the ball here. So Alvarado, who averages almost 43 yards per punt this year. Now, if If that's offside, this is going to give South Florida first down.
I'm sure the Louisville player is going to say he moved that football, and I thought I saw the football moving.
That's not the call, though.
Offside, number 99 of the defense. Unabated to the punter. A 5-yard penalty results in a first down.
Boy, that, you just can't do that, Coach. Well, you just can't do that.
I'd like to see if the snapper didn't move that football, because I think that's what Earl Hyman saw.
For the record, I'd like to see it again, too. Hard to tell right in the middle of your screen now. Well, it's hard to tell. No. Our view is blocked from the ball. He moved his head for sure. But the call on the field was offside now. It looks like this one might come back. Got a hold now. Another penalty flag thrown in the backfield. By the way, I know you know this, Coach, but just for our audience's purposes, that last play, that offsides play, that's not a reviewable play.
No.
That's something just for us to review, but that's a judgment call on the part of the
officials. We have two fouls by the offense on the play. Holding, number 61. That penalty's declined. Illegal block below the waist, back towards the position of the ball, number 11, offense. 15-yard penalty, still first down.
And Marcus Edwards came back inside, blocked below the waist. And Jim Leavitt right now is concerned about his football team, because even though they're ahead 20-3, you don't want to get sloppy.
Yep.
And let Brian Brown and this offense back in this football game. He's got to nail as many points as he can.
You said it right too, Coach. Brian Brown. I mean, that one name has got to strike fear into you if you're a coach.
If you're Jim Leavitt right now, you're thinking Brian Brown.
Sure,
Brian,
you are.
Everything's Brian Brown.
You've been
Brown.
Going to bed every night, getting Brian that Brown. 1 hour of sleep a night, thinking Brian Brown. How are we going to stop that guy?
I've seen some horror movies, but it's in football with good quarterbacks that you're going to play against, because they can make plays. But Louisville tonight does not look to me like they're focused right now. Something's got to happen.
Well, it started right from that opening kickoff. The opening kickoff, and it goes for a touchdown. Now Kragthorpe's into it with the officials.
I think he's still arguing about that play before the offside.
On the offense, 10-yard penalty. Gives the defense a more advantage. That penalty will be enforced from the line of scrimmage, first down.
See, the thing about basketball, you can get a technical and spark your team. Football, you can't do that. But some coaches do.
Oh, yeah.
Get a penalty. And right now, I'm not sure he's not trying to get his football team back in this football game.
Well, he's giving it to every official out there. Now there will be an unsportsmanlike conduct call against Kragthorpe. I think you're right, Coach. I think this was almost an intentional.
I tell you what, I've been on that sideline before when things are not going well and you want to get a spark in your football team, you have to figure a way to get them going, because you can't bring 11 guys in the auto. You can't bring all these 65 in.
Well, it hasn't stopped them. Now, they threw a flag, but they haven't marked off any yardage here. Grothy to run it, and he'll gain about 6.
I think the flag was maybe a warning. I saw a flag on the field. I did not hear the official say anything about a sideline warning or anything like that.
Well, they're doing that in basketball now, to point that out. That's one of those rules of emphasis this year in college basketball, is to try to keep those guys in their box.
Tell you what you'd like to have is your football team have to fire as a head coach.
He's really trying to put a light of fire under his team right now. Good pass and run. Torres Johnson gains about 6 more after the catch.
First year in a job is the toughest. Steve Kragthorpe knows that. But you got to make changes. You got to do some things that you may not want to do, but you got to set the law down.
Well, 3rd and 6 here. Now another flag comes in. Looks like it's going to be an illegal procedure call against the Bulls.
Prior to snap, ball starts. Number 11, offense, 5-yard penalty. Still third down.
That's on Marcus Edwards. Jim Leavitt's thinking of one thing. Brian Brohm.
Sloppy. He's thinking of two things. We're sloppy right now, Brian Brohm. We're sloppy now, Brian Brohm. Where's he at, Brian Brohm?
He has just eaten his cereal in the morning. He's been thinking of Brian Brohm all week. Now Florida 2-3 on third down. They're not going to get this one. A sack, a rare sack, because Grothy moved so well. Good play here defensively by Deion Palmer as we get you for another SportsCenter U update with the L train.
All right, Dave, West Virginia and Cincinnati. Pat White with a 7-yard touchdown run. He has 40 rushing yards so far, and West Virginia up 14-10. And then OU Texas Tech, Michael Crabtree down to the 1. Tech scoring on the next play. They lead, and Sam Bradford is out for Oklahoma. We'll update you on his condition when we got that information.
Wow, that's a big blow for the Sooners. Their quarterback, talented freshman quarterback, out for OU. High punt, not a good one. Kind of off the side of his foot, but it takes a good bounce. And will roll inside the 20. So Alvarado gets the benefit of the bounce. And it winds up being a 36-yard punt. Well, here we are at Raymond James Stadium in Tampa, Florida. Of course, the Buccaneers play here. With Mike Gottfried and Melissa Knowles, I'm Dave Armstrong. Watching South Florida and Louisville. Louisville looking for their 6th win. But, Coach, I am absolutely in agreement with you that I think they need to. I really believe that they need to win this week, and then we need to win next week at home against Rutgers. That would seal the deal. You know, if they get 6, they're eligible, but boy, there are a lot of teams that would be eligible to go along with them. The one thing that might help them is they have a lot of marquee value for selection committees with Brohm and with the fact that they were in the top 10 to start this year. A selection committee can look at them and say, hey, they're a very attractive team to put in here.
I agree with you. Here's the other thing. They bring people. Louisville always follows their football team. Now, Papa John's Bowl in Birmingham would be a good place for them against, say, Southern Mississippi, yep. Conference USA.
Brohm, given time, and that'll put Brohm in the record books in the Big East Conference. The pass completed to Harry Douglas, and now Brohm is the all-time leader in the Big East. He passes Ken Dorsey of Miami. Yeah, when Miami was in the Big East Conference. So now Brohm has more career yards in the Big East than any other quarterback in history.
Brian Brohm is a winner. He's 28. He's 23-8 as a starter. He's one play away from getting this team back in this game.
Yep. First down here up to the 26. Play action, Brohm, wide open, beautiful catch and throw. Douglas still on the move. There's a flag on the play as Douglas is going into the end zone.
And that may be the one play, because I think this may be
holding.
Wow.
72 offense. 10-yard penalty. Still first down.
Brian Roach with a call, and it bring it all back.
Now, Brian Roach, number 72, is going to get the call. He just tackled his nose guard, but Harry Douglas shows you some acceleration here as he takes off.
So Kragthorpe continuing that steam that started about 10 minutes ago.
You know what Jim Leavitt's thinking about right now?
Brian Brohm. And boy, Brohm, am I glad we had a holding call.
I'm glad I saw that yellow flag.
Oh, man. It's, a lot of times, you know, you see scores in football and you think, what happened? But I guarantee you, you break it all down, and sometimes it comes down to a play just like that. So instead of a touchdown, it's first and 20. And now pass completed. And as he gets it to Scott Long, Long gets most of the 10 back from the penalty.
Scott Long, they have so many talented receivers, and they have really a good tight end down the middle, Gary Barnage, number 82. He's a welcome relief for Brian Brown to get the ball over the middle against two deep coverage.
Coach, you were looking at 35 is the magical number for Brown. He's thrown at least 35 passing attempts in 7 of the 10 games this year. That one a little bit too high for Patrick Carter. And that was his 9th throw of this game.
I'll guarantee you one thing right now. I don't know what's in your credit card or what's in your wallet, but I'll say this. He's going to go well over 35 tonight.
Oh, yeah. I'd put the over-under number at 45. And I might take the over.
Maybe higher. What's in your wallet?
Not much.
I know you got nickels and dimes. I've seen you this year.
I know. You're still waiting for me to buy dinner at least once, aren't you? Knocked away. Good defensive play by Carlton Williams coming up from his safety spot. Pass intended for Yerudia. Carlton Williams, number 32, is in on the stop.
This is a good secondary. Carlton Williams.
And that is Williams down.
Yeah, Michael Jenkins, Nate Allen, and Trey Williams. Michael Jenkins, Mel Kiper, and Todd McShay may be the best corner in the country. Here's a break by Carlton Williams.
Brian Brown. The blow here, and watch. Good pass again right on target, but then there was that collision.
Yeah.
And coming out of that play, Ryan Gilliam, who thought he might have had a pick. Now the concern here for Carlton Williams. A junior out of Georgia. Let's take one more look.
Brian Brown delivers. Carlton Williams steps in with his head.
He gets up, yeah. And then
goes right back down.
Could be a stinger.
Yep.
You know, the fact that he got up right away is a good sign. I think it just kind of knocked him woozy. It happens. I'm that's what we're hoping for. That just kind of temporarily knocked him woozy, and he's going to be okay. And there are a lot of the players down, kind of on one knee.
You worked so hard at football practice starting in August, but starts well before that with conditioning and lifting weights and running, and you do not want to see somebody get hurt. And
never.
All players, you know, speaking, they know the effort.
Seeing a man go down in green, it reminds you of Dixon earlier this week, and unfortunately the quarterback for Oregon who goes down, and he's out with an ACL injury for the rest of this year. Takes Oregon out of the national title hopes, takes him out of the Heisman race. It's just unfortunate. And, you know, Jim Leavitt was telling us yesterday, he said when he saw that, he said, I shed a tear. He said, yeah. I just felt so bad for him and for his family.
Again, you don't realize sometimes the effort that goes into the practice and the time trying to refine your skills and be a part of the team.
All right, while they tend to Carlton Williams, we'll certainly hope for the best. We'll come back and update you on his condition in a moment. Well, Carlton Williams is walking toward the locker room, but the good news is he's walking. He woke up, actually, and smiled. He's waving to the crowd. He's got a serious headache, I'm sure. A punt here by Corey Getchie, taken on a hop, dangerously so, by Marcus Edwards, but he hangs onto the ball and hit immediately by Beaumont.
Should have been blocked.
Let's go down to Melissa Knowles, who's been strolling the sidelines on both sides. What's the demeanor down there, Melissa?
That's right, Dave. When I'm over here on the South Florida side, everybody's up on their feet. They're cheering. They're excited. But they know there's still a lot of football to be played. But they don't need anybody to rev them up. Now, when you go over to the Louisville side, these guys have their heads hanging low. And all the assistant coaches are over there giving pep talks. Dave?
Thanks a lot. Melissa, I tell you, the mental anguish that both these teams really have gone through this year, the three straight losses by South Florida. But, Coach, the five losses by Louisville, that matches the number of losses they've had in their last 3 years.
Yeah, 12-1 last year. You expect to win. But, again, I think Steve Kragthorpe's the right guy at the right time for Louisville. I think he's got a great coaching staff. But I think you have to put this on the players.
I do, too. You know, sometimes we always look at the coach, but, you know, when do the players have accountability? Well, 2nd and 6 here. And this time, Grothy on the keeper. He'll have the first down and more. Hit down at the 40-yard line. John Russell with the stop there. But another first down, a gain of 10 more for Grothy.
And, Dave, you talk about Louisville. They've lost 4 games by 7 or less points.
Right.
So they've been in every game. They just can't find a way to win some of those games.
Yeah, and for South Florida, they're 3 losses by an average of 5 per game. So they can all, both these teams can look back at this season and go, man, if and but and all those things. What's that saying? If ifs and buts were candies and nuts, we'd all have a Merry Christmas. Let's get an update on that game between West Virginia.
Maybe he'll give you this save, too.
Might have. Here's Lowell Galindo.
Well, the Mountaineers go on a 73-yard scoring drive. Pat White with 72 of the total yards. 4-yard touchdown to cap that one. 21-10, West Virginia rolling. Back to Dave and Coach.
All right, West Virginia, they're the Big East best hope for possible getting into that national title race.
I think they have a real good shot.
5th coming in. Pass completed here. Again, Cedric Hill, the tight end, as he gets it up to midfield. Deion Palmer, the stop, but he'll move the chains again.
Again, Matt Grothy with a strong arm gets the first down.
Oh, look at that. 7s are wild for Matt Grothy. 7s and 67. Numbers he ought to play in Powerball or something. A big hole opens up again. Mike Ford and some tough yards. And that defense, they just try to stay warm at Selby. He just can't wait. That engine is always burning, isn't it?
Yeah, that's the best defense against Louisville's offense. Your offense, keep them on the other side of the field on the benches with Melissa.
Yeah, it looks like Ford is down. We're going down to Melissa.
I'm not there.
No, no, it's Mike Ford who is down. And then we actually have 2 players down. Mike Ford is down near midfield, and then the other player, Cedric Hill, he's also down. So 2 go down on the same play.
Mike Ford took a real good hit at the end of the running play.
Let's look at it again.
And Mike Ford gets the handoff, works upfield right there. Nice tackle by Lamar Miles.
Now, Cedric Hill is just sort of ancillary to this play, really. And he was hit. I think he was looking back in on the play, and then he was hit. And he is still down. Ford's okay. He's over on the sideline talking. But Hill, still concerned there, as he is still down on the field.
A lot of times, Dave, a player will become a spectator and get hit.
Well, ESPNU brings you more college basketball tomorrow night. It's the Iona Gaels taking on top-ranked North Carolina. College basketball Sunday night at 6 Eastern. I'm going to go out on a limb and take the Tar Heels.
I like North Carolina, too.
That's good.
I think somewhere I read
they're okay.
They're number one.
They're not bad.
Rushing yardage. first quarter for South Florida. They had 154 yards. Then Louisville played some better run defense, only giving up 18 yards here in the second quarter.
Of course, North Carolina beat Davidson by only four the other night. But they're very, very good. Another good run here. As running to the outside, Aston Samuels. And then Samuels gets yet another first down, or at least close to it. They may measure, they're going to. And now there goes Samuels hopping off. I think on, what, four of the last five plays, we've had a bull either be carried off the field or helped off the field or hop off the field.
Tell you what the bulls are seeing right now, red. Yep. They're trying to work their way in this end zone and try to put a kneel in this Louisville defense.
Well, they're doing a lot of this on the ground too, which is eating up lots of time. Grothy, that was well designed, but yet a great defensive play there by Brandon Cox as he jumps up his 6'4" frame to get in the way.
Brandon Cox is 6'4", 6'4", jumps up, and Matt Grothy had a play there. That was a good play call based on the reverse of the toss sweep, the play before that worked together with that play.
So Cox with a nice block shot, sticking with our basketball theme. That's the first incomplete pass for Grothy. Given lots of time by that offensive line. Pass completed to Edwards, who was hit immediately. The hit coming from Johnny Patrick.
Johnny Patrick, a freshman from DeLand, Florida. One of a number of 18 players from the state of Florida that play on this Louisville football team.
Well, at the 34, South Florida needs the 29 for the first down. They are 2 for 4 on third down conversions tonight. Grothy, quick hitter across the middle for the first down. That pass completed to Courtney Denson. And a well-designed play. This little slant route across the middle.
When you go to the empty set, all of a sudden you get linebackers on receivers. Denson's working against Miles, the linebacker, number 22, and he wins the battle.
So they move the chains again, and South Florida again nearing that red zone. Tough couple of yards here. Good play defensively by Willie Williams. As we get you back to Lowell Galindo for an update on Tech and Oklahoma.
Yeah, guys, Sam Bradford is still out for OU and Texas Tech taking full advantage. Graham Harrell to Michael Crabtree for the touchdown. It's 20-7 Texas Tech. And also coming up on the SportsCenter U halftime report, we're going to get you completely caught up with the Big East, tell you what UConn's doing. Lloyd Carr out at Michigan will update you on that, and a complete rundown of the top 25.
Wow. Also a report, Mark May was reporting that Houston Nutt may be out at Arkansas. Lloyd Carr, great tenure at Michigan. All the things he did there, including winning a national championship.
I think Lloyd Carr is a very good football coach. If indeed he's out, Brian Kelly in Cincinnati, Les Miles at LSU will be the two guys that the phones will be ringing for. Because Brian Kelly, you go back when they hired Bo Schembecker. They got him out of the Mid-American. Brian Kelly won at Central Michigan, and now he's at Cincinnati. He would be a logical choice.
And so too would Les Miles, as Michigan ties. That pass incomplete and almost picked off. Boy, good play defensively by Woody Terrain.
You talk about Les Miles. He played at Michigan under Bo Schembecker from Barberton, Ohio, so he knows that area. Married his wife. His wife was from the Michigan campus, so everybody always asks me, would he go? I'd say he'll go if he gets the job.
Well, here comes Alvarado on for field goal attempt. Alvarado has missed 10 this year. He's 15 of 25. But this one is true. Now penalty flag comes in. This is going to be roughing the holder.
Yeah, they're going to take this points off if they got that first down.
Roughing the kicker, actually. He went right through the kicker and the holder.
Yeah, the offense is going to come back on here for South Florida.
Well, what more can Louisville do wrong here tonight?
They've made so many mistakes here.
Starting with the opening kickoff that they fumbled, was taken in for a touchdown by South Florida.
Hey, yo.
That's an
easy
automatic
choice
first down,
there for Jim Leavitt.
Yeah.
And again, you always teach your guys when they're going to block a kick, lay out, but do not run into anybody. And Woody Terrain.
Yeah, Woody Terrain.
Ran right into the kick.
So now it makes it a first and goal at the 7. Crothy. That's just really good stuff. And into the back of the end zone to Edwards for a touchdown. That is just great stuff from Crothy to keep that play alive.
And you know, right after the penalty, your defense comes back on. They're down the dumps. And Matt Crothy makes it pay. Marcus Edwards going to get in the back of the end zone. His feet really keeps this play alive. And then a strong arm to get the ball to Edwards.
Edwards, his first touchdown grab of the year. Crothy's run for one, pass for one. And the point after is good.
The extra point is good.
So Matt Crothy continues to impress. He's only had two incompletions all night, and this one he keeps alive with his feet and then a strong touchdown pass. Now South Florida leads it now 27-3. Louisville, they have just really stuck their foot in it here tonight. Trent Guy started it off. He fumbled that opening kickoff. They had a penalty of offsides on when South Florida was punting. The last time they had a penalty on roughing the kicker and what would have been a field goal, they just handed South Florida 4 more points. It has not been pretty for Louisville.
Just not in the football game here in the first half.
So it's Guy and Powell back deep. And it comes to the up man. That is returned in there by Jarriott Huey. And I don't know where in the world Melissa Knowles went to. I think she's on a cruise all of a sudden. Melissa, what's going on?
You know, it is something like a cruise. I'm over here on this pirate ship. Now, it is 103-foot 43-ton steel and concrete replica of a pirate ship. I've got some USF students behind me. I think they're super excited to be here. But in the spirit of being a pirate, I think I'm going to steal somebody's beads because they're really cool. Let me have your beads. Dave.
A true pirate. Brom able to find Mitchell. This is going in for the score. There's the quick strike ability of Brian Brom, and no flags on this play. 59 yards for the touchdown.
Well, we talked about Jim Leavitt having bad dreams about Brian Brom, and he's one play away from getting your team back in the game. Brian Brom with the pump fake. They got him on the fake hitch and then take off. Brian Brom laid it right out there.
Harry Douglas with another touchdown grab. That's his 7th of the year.
Melissa, that ship's not sailing just yet.
Not yet. It's kind of stuck in harbor now after they were able to get that touchdown pass to Harry Douglas. 59-yard play. little fake to the outside, and then Douglas gets behind the secondary for the score for Louisville. Now that man in the middle of the screen, number 12, Brian Brom, he's now thrown 29 touchdowns this year against just 9 interceptions. And this last one to Harry Douglas, the 7th time they've hooked up this year. That was a 59-yard pass play, a one-play drive, Coach, that took 14 seconds.
And that's what they can do. Even without the running game, everything's got to be based on throwing the ball. But they're a quick strike offense.
They don't get much quicker than that. Here comes Murphy at the 10. Trying to get it back to the other side of the field. Well, there's a flow. There's 1, 2, 3, gun flags. 6, 7, everybody. If people in the stands had a flag, they'd be throwing them. Could be a face mask.
Say you'd be safe to say that.
Well, when this, the election gets closer, I'm trying to be politically correct.
What an election.
Yeah. Next year. What election. I'll look at it again. Darius Mann. Yikes.
Great field position for South Florida to begin with.
All right, let's go back to Melissa, who is still being held hostage on the pirate ship.
I don't know if I'm being held hostage so much as I'm having so much fun. I stole somebody's hat. Isn't that cute?
Yeah.
I'm here with a former student. You came back to this game, last home game of the year. What brought you back?
To support the USF football team that had an amazing year, but we want to see them continue next year. All the fans are here, and it's, you know, put USF on the map this year.
And if you guys go to a bowl game, how would that make you feel if you go to a bowl game? I think that sums it up. Dave?
Melissa in the student section. It's, by the way, the biggest student section in the Big East Conference by 1. They are all living the dream.
Living the dream. I've heard that before.
Have you? 4:40 left to go. Now, Grothy's got to go back on the attack here.
Louisville still has all their timeouts left, so they'd like to stop this offense, get the ball back, and let Brian Brom get them closer.
We're outlining all the mistakes that Louisville has made in this first half. And their defense hasn't done much to stop the opposition. Carlton Mitchell with another catch, but I also forgot one. Remember the one big play that they completed from Brom to Douglas that was either out at the 1 or in the end zone, and the holding call brought it all the way back.
Dave, 38 plays for South Florida's offense, 20 for Louisville, so that's good defense on Brian Brom to keep him off the field.
It's the best defense against Brom. Boy, a high snap, and that kind of play, it really stalled that play, the high snap, and threw the timing off.
Matt Grothy looked like a rat in a maze right there, but he's just trying to find a way out right there.
Kind of looked over the sideline and go, what in the world was I supposed to do?
He'll tell the center, hey, that was high.
That was a little high.
Get it down.
Grothy only 6 feet tall.
Here's what Louisville's not been able to do, stop him on third down.
Yep. 2nd and 11 here. Grothy throwing off his back foot and then incomplete.
Pretty good coverage right there by John Russell.
Yep, Ben Busby was the intended target.
This is a big down now. Talked about third down. They have not been good.
I think Grothy was saying, did that hit him in the side of the head? He said, I think that pass hit him right in the side of the helmet. Well, 3 for 6 on third down, but this is a 3rd and 11, and they're out of field goal range.
A big down for Louisville's defense. Get the ball back.
Looks like they want to come with pressure. Now they'll drop back. Grothy. He's got his man. Is it enough for the first down? It is going to be very, very close. Pass caught by Jesse Hester Jr.
I'm going to say it's short. Jesse Hester has been a big play wide receiver for this South Florida offense.
It is a first down. Yeah, you're right. Hester was the one that caught the touchdown in overtime. That beat Auburn.
27 receptions for Jesse Hester. 20 have gone for first downs, 4 for TDs. So he's a big play wide receiver. I thought he was short, but he may have got a good spot.
So on that third and 11, they're able to convert. Now Grothy goes into the end zone for the touchdown. Boy, that was easy to Carlton Mitchell. His fourth grab for a touchdown this year.
Go back to Dave. If you can't stop him on third down, there's going to be a flag for celebration on South Florida on the kickoff. But when you can't stop him on third down, you give up a big play. And then Matt Grothy has confidence and comes back and makes that throw. Jim Leavitt's down here going to be concerned. But four of the offensive players for South Florida were around the cheerleaders doing a dance, and the referee was there, and it caught him for the unsportsmanlike conduct.
It certainly wasn't Mitchell, because he just handed the ball back to the official.
No, it was over here. Jim Leavitt just got the numbers, and he's looking for some people right now.
Oh, boy. And they're not wanting to be found.
Well, first of all, you go to the coach and say, hey, I don't like this. And then you figure the coach is going to go get the players.
Somehow I think that will be addressed. Well, the extra point from Alvarado, and they'll tack the penalty yards onto the kickoff, which should give Louisville a chance. Kick is good. Grothy, another touchdown pass. This one 30 yards to Mitchell.
Yeah, Matt Grothy gets great protection. Mitchell wide open. That's too easy.
This game is starting to look a lot like 2005, Coach, and you know, not as much of a stunner this year. In fact, South Florida favored to win this game. They weren't favored in 2005. Louisville came into this game a top 10 team with national title hopes, and it was just too much South Florida in this game.
The Amari Jackson show, because they ran a reverse, caught a touchdown pass, ran a reverse, comes back with another reverse, and then even throws a reverse pass. But here again, it's Amari Jackson show. They got up early, held on, and beat Louisville 45-14.
We talked to Jim Leavitt about that game. And again, nationally, that's really what put South Florida on the map. And he agrees with that. But for, in his mind, the Pittsburgh game a couple of years before that, that's what really, when he felt like we've turned the corner and we've become a legitimate Division I team.
And I think when they beat Pittsburgh, that's when the seeds were sowed for them to get in the Big East.
Yep, that's right. By the way, South Florida will go to a bowl game for the third straight year. That means half of the years they've been in the football bowl subdivision, they'll go to a bowl game. That's pretty good. Short kick. Again, after that penalty, good opportunity here for Louisville. Powell. And Powell takes it across midfield. And still with all those timeouts left for Brian Braum, a chance for him to score a touchdown. A 25-yard return.
Powell's been a good addition on the kickoff return because he honks it up in there.
He what?
Runs.
He does what?
Honks it up there.
Does he?
He does. You want to tell him one more time?
Is that a Canadian geese?
I think so. It could be.
He's honking it up in there. Well, right now, Brian Braum has only got 46 yards to go. Of course, his last play, 59-yard touchdown pass to Harry Douglas. On the draw. Lots of time for Braum. My goodness. Now scrambling. throwing on the run, and that pass is incomplete. Wow, what a great play by Braum, but incomplete, intended for Scott Kuhn.
That was great coverage by South Florida. They ran takeoffs on both sides of the field. Both these corners, Mike Jenkins and Trey Williams, stayed right with the receivers. There was no place for Brian Braum to throw the football.
You know, Bussey did a pretty good job there on George Selby. Selby wound up putting the pressure on, but it took him a long time to get there. So second and 10. Intercepted. This one is picked off by Williams, his fifth interception of the year, skirting the sideline and into the end zone for the touchdown. Wow! Yards on the return.
Now Mario Urrutia just bobbled the football long enough and then dropped in the hands of Williams. Here's Mario Urrutia, should have had that pass. Trey Williams, excellent defensive back for South Florida, and with speed to burn his fifth interception, his 15th career interception.
Looked like Bruce Mompremier tipped that ball at the line, and that kind of set everything in motion. Yeah, there's a little tip there. Then Urrutia loses the handle. Good hands by Williams to pick it off and then return it.
How about the speed, though? I mean, once he gets to the sideline, there's nobody going to catch him.
No, he was honking.
He was honking and honking.
And then it was Mompremier who went down. He was the one that originally tipped that ball. Turned that whole play into a pinball machine.
Boy, what great field position that Louisville had. Yep. Didn't take advantage of. And South Florida makes you pay. Their secondary is maybe the best in the country.
In Louisville, they can sense their bowl bid kind of slipping away. Loss here tonight by Louisville will drop them under 500. Never thought I'd say those words this year. Extra point is good. 41 to 10 in this game. Well, let's get you an update with Lowell Galindo.
Well, guys, Mike Leach is loving the Big 12 reps in this one because they keep on throwing up their hands to signal Texas Tech touchdown. Like on this one, Graham Harrell to Eric Morris. Red Raiders leading 27-7. Sam Bradford still out for OU.
Boy, interesting now, 27-7 Tech. A lot of people thought that if someone had a chance to lose today, it could be Kansas or Missouri. There weren't many people talking about Oklahoma, but you look at that Tech. They have that high-powered offense. They can put points on the board.
A tough place to play. When Lubbock, Texas, very difficult to go in there. Oklahoma's finding that out with Bradford being hurt tonight.
There's the BCS rankings as of last week. Of course, Oregon losing this week. So Kansas, they won today against Iowa State. They figure to move up. Missouri, they won today against Kansas State. They probably will move up. West Virginia winning, they may move up. I'll tell you, teams like Ohio State and West Virginia now, more hope of getting into that national title picture.
I think West Virginia's in the best shape, though, because if they win, just continue to win, they're ahead of Ohio State right now.
Here comes Powell. Here come flags.
Block in the back.
So this will mark them back half the distance to the goal. Another mistake for Louisville. You know what? And they're getting frustrated now.
Yeah.
And the officials have got to do a good job to make sure this doesn't get out of hand. I mean, the frustrations of a very disappointing year are starting to pour out onto the field for the Cardinals.
There's times when you have a football team, when you're coaching, the wheels come off. This may be Louisville's wheels coming off.
wheels on the bus aren't going round and round.
No, they're off right now.
This is an easy call here. Yeah, that's definitely a block in the back. Something wrong with our referee's mic tonight, John McDade. If we had Melissa up here, we could read his lips, but we'll try to figure it out for you. Basically, one penalty was refused, the other one was accepted. The block in the back was refused, the personal foul, that was accepted, and that marks it back half the distance to the 13.
Here's where you expect George Selby right now to get in the action, because Louisville's got to throw. They may run here first down, but they got to throw.
Well, they do run the ball, and they're able to get it up across the 20. George Stripling with the carry.
Keep your eye on 95.
George Stripling.
95, of course, George Selby. Didn't have a sack yet tonight. And right now, sitting over on the sidelines. Cooling his heel. Hard to get a sack from over there.
He could do it.
Woody did it.
I like what they're doing, resting him a play or two. He's going to come back on the field right now. Dan McCartney said he's relentless, does a great job with his hands.
Yeah, don't forget, coming up at halftime, Tom and Lowell, the L train rolling on from Sports Center U. They're going to have the West Virginia UConn. Are they on a collision course with West Virginia playing tonight? Lloyd Carr, is he stepping down? Was that his last game at the Big House today? And of course, lots of highlights from the top 25. Missouri and Kansas, coach, they're on a collision course next week at Arrowhead Stadium.
Next week, and I like this Missouri football team. Yeah. Chase Daniel, and they got to.
Is he a Heisman candidate for you?
Oh, I think he's in the lead right now. I know you feel the same way.
Yeah, I think he's one of those guys you've got to look at now. Pass is complete. Pass comes out to Scott Long. They mark the ball up to the 35-yard line of first down. 19 to go.
You talk about George Bussey. He's 6'4", 300 pounds out of Louisville. He's got his hands full with George Selby now. George Selby just thinking. He knows Brian Brown's got to throw the ball. He's going to pin his ears back and just rush upfield.
Now it's whistle dead. Lots of movement on both sides. Well, that'll be offside on Selby, I think. That's offside number 95. I read his lips. George Selby.
I tell you what, George is saying, I know they're going to throw. I'm trying to get a start here, but he doesn't need a start.
He was recruited as an offensive lineman, as a center. He wanted to play center. He'd always played on the offensive line in high school. How do you go from being a center to a 242-pound defensive end that is this good, that's All-American? Brom airs it out. And this ball out of bounds. A little bit of a collision over there. Douglas, the intended receiver, did that pass out of bounds. Stops the clock with 1:13 remaining and makes it second and five.
They doubled George Selby last play. Now you have to have help. Watch George Selby here. They say, okay, you're an All-American. Not getting in here this time.
They'd like Selby to put on another 15 or 20 pounds. He's trying, and he said it's a pudgy kid, but then all of a sudden he grew and he became 6'4" and lost a lot of that baby fat. Brom steps up, and Brom, that'll be positive yards as he gets the ball up to the 44, but it keeps the clock moving.
Good job by Woody George, number 96. Rushing the passer, spinning out, making the tackle on Brian Brown.
So Selby getting a breather again. Timeout taken here by Louisville. They still have two remaining. And facing a third and a very short one. Third and one.
I want to go back to Lloyd Carr. I hope he stays, but I think the decision will be made the next, either today, tomorrow, Monday, because you have recruiting, so you can't wait too long. So
is this a retirement, coach, do you think?
I think it
by
will
Carr
be.
Or is
I
it,
think it will
because
be
of the way the season started and then the way Ohio State has really dominated over the last 5 or 6 years in that series?
I think it's a combination of all those things, but the retirement would make sense.
Yeah,
I thought he did a great coaching job after Appalachian got him and then Oregon to keep that team on track and come back. He did a good job, but Brian Kelly, Les Miles, I thought about Greg Schiano up at Rutgers because when you think about Michigan, it's got to be one of the 10 best jobs
absolutely.
In the country.
Absolutely. Fan base is incredible. They play in the big house.
I'd say the guy at Cincinnati, Brian Kelly, has the best shot
seriously,
other than Les Miles.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Other than Les Miles. I don't know if that's a first down or not. Anthony Allen running hard. And I think with second effort, he got it.
The reason I say that, Dave, is the roadmap, how they got Bo Schembechler out of the Mid-American Conference, Miami of Ohio. He was a winning coach. Brian Kelly coached in the Mid-American.
Yep.
He's got Michigan ties. He's coached in Michigan.
That makes a lot of sense, and he's had great success at Cincinnati. It's a good call. I mean, I know Les Miles isn't going to want to talk about it until the season is over, but you would figure he would be the front runner. I mean, and it's going to be a hard job for him to turn down, even though he's got LSU cranking away.
I said on Inside the Post with Lowe and Tommy Luganville that he would crawl up Route 65 through the South on his hands and knees for the Michigan job.
Well,
yes,
it's a special job. And for him especially, since he played there, as you mentioned, his wife there, from there, will be coming home. Pass is incomplete. There was contact, but that pass, it wasn't catchable. Again, intended for Douglas. So now third and five. Brom upset with himself. He really had Douglas a step on the defender, and he felt like he should have hit him.
And Douglas beat Trey Williams on that play, which is an outstanding corner. You noticed they have not been able to get anything on the other side. Yeah. Mike Jenkins. Mike Jenkins is so good at the corner position.
He's a Thorpe Award candidate. And according to ESPN.com, that man right there, Mike Jenkins, he is the ninth best pro prospect out there. Could be a free play here for Louisville. And this one tipped just at the last second by the aforementioned Jenkins. Look at that coverage by Jenkins, that closing speed. Pass intended for Long.
Wally Burnham, the defensive coordinator, says about Mike Jenkins, he said he really baits the quarterback into throwing. He kind of lags behind a little bit, makes the play, but he compares him to Deion Sanders, who he coached at Florida State. He said, I don't ever compare a guy to Deion Sanders, but I have to compare Mike Jenkins.
Well, that was offsides against South Florida. So now, instead of fourth down and six, it's third and a short one. There's Wally Burnham. Wally Burnham, the associate head coach and defensive coordinator. And so stop the clock long enough to move the chains with 35 seconds remaining, and again, still two timeouts remaining for Brom.
Kerry Barnage, the tight end, he's not going to him yet.
This will be the 10th play of this drive. Brom throwing off his back foot, and the pass is incomplete. Ooh, almost a great catch there by Long.
Took a hit by Alan Cray, number 94. Brian Brom didn't have long. I've been impressed with Brian Brom's toughness all year.
Yeah, boy,
he
no
kidding. He takes some hits.
There's so many things to be impressed about Brian Brom. The fact that he wanted to come back, get his degree. He's going to get his degree in 3.5 years at Louisville. Knee injury that suffered last year. Braum. Again, across the middle, and again, a little bit too far. Pass over there intended for Carter and just out of his reach.
He had Carter broke free after he adjusted his route with all the time Brian Braum had. Brian Braum looking for somebody, a good coverage by South Florida, buys some time. All of a sudden, Pat Carter breaks out of the worrying about Tyler Robertson nickelback and got away from him, but the throw was too high.
Well, it's third and 10, and Braum is 0 for his last five. Look out, Selby was coming. Braum lets it go, and it's picked off in the end zone by Jenkins. What an interception by Jenkins in the end zone. His third pick of the year.
That's one of those plays, Dave, where Brian Braum just threw it because he was under pressure by George Selby. Nothing was open downfield. He was hoping something in the last 10 seconds would be an interference or a catch, some miraculous play, but Jenkins was right there. Pressure from George Selby comes upfield. Brian Braum's got time, but all of a sudden Selby comes in. I think he just threw that ball up there trying to make something happen.
Well, this is the classic getting the wind knocked out of you as he fell right on that ball.
You've had that happen,
I'm sure.
Yes, many times. You're talking about a first-round draft pick. Right,
there have been a few things I've said this year that have taken your breath away.
Yes. Living the dream.
Yeah. And so I'm going to go out on a limb here and say Jenkins is going to be fine. He's just, when you get the wind knocked out of you, folks, you just feel like you want to die.
Oh, yeah.
It's just like you're gasping over there, like, oh, I want to catch a breath, please. But what a spectacular interception by Jenkins. The second interception of the night for the Bulls. Williams has won his fifth. Jenkins now has his third. And don't forget, everything that you need to know about college sports is right here at your source, ESPNU.com. I know that Coach has that bookmarked on his laptop. It's ESPNU.com. It's an online service that's your gateway to all things college sports. And by the way, if you don't have ESPNU, what are you waiting for? Call your local cable operator or satellite provider and get it today.
I would have that bookmarked, but I don't own a laptop.
Well, let's go back to Lowell Galindo while we're waiting.
He has a laptop.
Yeah, I'm sure he does. Yeah, he's hip. Let's go to Lowell.
Hey, guys. Well, coming up at the SportsCenter U Halftime Report, we're going to get into the Big East picture right now. West Virginia and Cincinnati, still a conference that is very much up in the air. Mountaineers and Bearcats both in this for the Big East title. How do you expect to see this conference play out, Tom?
Well, I think we're going to look for a collision course between West Virginia and UConn coming here real shortly. It's going to be interesting.
All right, we're going to get you back out to Dave Armstrong and Coach Mike Gottfried. Coach, by the way, really looking forward to you coming back for Inside the Polls on Monday.
Thank you, Lowell, and I'm looking forward to seeing you and Tom and all the guys there.
Jenkins caught his breath. He'll just go on into the locker room now as we're closing in on halftime and putting the L train to work. Lowell Galindo, Tom Luganville are getting ready to go to work at halftime.
I know they're going to talk about the collision. Connecticut and West Virginia. I don't think that's going to be a collision.
All right, you heard it here
first. I'm going to hold my victory to the second half.
Well, this is some collision here. First half, all South Florida as they take a 41-10 lead into the halftime. And now let's go to the L train. Lowell and Tom, SportsCenter U. Yeah, that's our halftime score, folks. South Florida 41. Louisville 10, South Florida just rolled over the Cardinals in that first half. Hi again, everyone. I'm Dave Armstrong, along with the coach, Mike Gottfried. And, Mike, it's gut check time right now for Louisville.
Really is. I think Steve Kragthorpe's going to challenge them at halftime to give a better effort here in the second half. When you can't run the ball and you can't play defense, you're in trouble.
Yeah, they're in trouble right now, no question, in this game. And then their bowl hopes are certainly going out the window. Boy, the first half, it started poorly for Louisville as they fumbled the opening kickoff.
And Nate Allen with the return. Now Mike Ford, the offensive line opened up some big holes. And then Matt Grothy hits him with the run. Matt Grothy with a nice pass right here to Marcus Edwards. Matt Grothy with a wide open receiver right here, Carlton Mitchell. And then just everything. Trey Williams with the interception, takes it all the way back. They find a way to win. They find a way to score. The defense has been good. The offense has been good. And special teams has been good.
So we start the second half, and guess who will get the ball first? South Florida. Already lead 41-10 here at halftime. And here comes the kickoff. A short kick at the 8-yard line, hauled in. And then stopped shy of the 20-yard line. As we get on to Melissa Knowles for an update.
That's right, Dave. You know, I talked to Coach Leavitt, and even though they're ahead by 31 points right now, he told me that Brian Brohm is still their biggest concern, and they have got to continue to play well and put the ball in the end zone. Now, on the other side of the ball, Steve Kragthorpe told me that, you know what, we have got to stop the other team from making big plays. We have got to get there and put some points in the end zone, or got to get this ball in the end zone. So I hope they can do it. I hope this continues to be a really good game because it's really exciting. Dave?
All right. Thanks a lot, Melissa. We'll see. I think for Louisville, what they have to prove, you know, you have bowl scouts that are watching you. And right now, Coach, Louisville is not making a statement like they want to play past the end of this regular season.
No, but South Florida is.
Oh, absolutely.
They're saying, hey, we want to move up like the Jeffersons. We want to move uptown. We want to move up the bowl list.
Going up the east side, huh?
Yeah.
Moving on up. There are those stats.
Turnovers, 3 for Louisville.
Look at the total yards. Amazing. Again, the run by Ford. He certainly had a better idea in that first half. So did the Bulls. He gets this one up to the 35-yard line. Second and 8. Second and 7. Long 7. Look at Grothy's numbers. That's about as efficient a first half as a quarterback can play.
Oh, you're right. And a lot of key plays on third down by Matt Grothy.
Grothy keeps it. And nothing doing. Maybe a half yard, that'll be it. It'll bring up third and long as Willie Williams is right there defensively. Now, if Louisville, this will give a real good sense right here, Coach.
Yeah.
If Louisville comes out of this locker room fresh and ready to go.
And they stop them on third down, but where Louisville's going to have to take some chances, it's to stop the run and let their receivers and DBs be one-on-one a little bit. So Matt Grothy may get some big plays on the outside.
If you're Steve Kragthorpe, Coach, you're in that locker room, are you saying to your team, look, your manhood is being challenged right now?
And rather loudly, he would say that.
Grothy throwing on the run, and he throws a perfect strike. Boy, he has shown great accuracy here tonight. And Torres Johnson makes the grab. A perfect name to play for the Bulls, Torres.
Yeah, Torres came open again, but Matt Grothy gets protection. A four-man rush. He moves out of the pocket. He throws across his body, but got the ball to Torres.
So all the way to midfield. Another third down conversion. Grothy again. Fake to Ford, Grothy, no gain.
There's a point in the game, Dave, where you break the will of the other team. They get their will broken, the defense and the offense and the special teams. And if South Florida can take this ball down the field and score here, I think they'll break the will of Louisville.
Second and 10. Grothy hit. That'll be a sack. as he's hit behind the line of scrimmage. Coming in, Lamar Miles from his middle linebacker spot.
And Lamar Miles had 13 tackles versus West Virginia, forced a fumble in that game, played outstanding. Third down again. Let's see if Louisville can find a key here.
5 for 8 on third down for USF. Oh, too much time.
They were coming with the blitz, and I think their offensive lineman of South Florida moved.
Part of the snap. False start. Number 61 offense. 5-yard penalty. Still third down.
Hey, there's John McDade. We can hear him this half.
Yeah. Got a battery. The bunny saw him at halftime.
He got a visit from the Easter Bunny.
Yeah.
Third and 18.
The bunny makes a visit every Monday to inside the polls with Mike Freer.
Yes, he does.
He's the only part of that show that's
makes
paid.
Sense. Oh, no. Yeah, that's a great show, folks. Inside the polls. Picked off. And that one is picked off. It was deflected, and then John Russell was in the right spot at the right time. And Brophy is picked for the first time in this game.
Now the defense has done what the coaches challenged them on. Now the offense got to do their part. Matt Grothy on the fake, the deflection, and John Russell picks the football off.
Carl Mitchell kind of waited and in traffic, and Grothy's like, you know, when we review that one later on, I'm going to be mad at myself because I really tried to force that ball in there and I didn't have to. Better to, you know, on third and 18, just take the medicine and go ahead and punt it away. A flag comes in. There could be a hold. For the moment, it's a first down for Louisville as the pass is completed to Brock Bolin.
Holding. Number 68 offense. 10-yard penalty. Still first down.
And that's on George Bussey, who's trying to keep George Selvey out of the backfield.
Yeah, first mistake Bussey has made.
Yeah, he's done a good job.
Selby's done a good job, and with all the passing in this football game, Brock Bolin's a good receiver. We saw him catch 4 passes that game we did at Cincinnati.
Probably the best game Louisville's played this
year.
They won that game at Cincinnati. I came away from that game just thinking Brian Brohm ought to be in the Heisman chase. Well, not now.
Yes, I mean, you did.
Not because of him. I still think he's the best quarterback in the land, and you do too. But, you know, their numbers as a team just don't stack up. And there's a drop pass. That was right on target to Patrick Carter, and he simply dropped it.
A lot of drops tonight. You really dropped one into the hands of Trey Williams for a TD, but Patrick Carter just can't hold on here.
Unofficially,
looks like he took his eyes off the ball.
Sorry, Coach. Unofficially, 5 drops. So 12 of 27, Brohm. Factor in 5 drops, so he could be 17 of 27. But those are un-Brohm-like numbers tonight, really. I mean, less than 50%. He's normally closer to 70%. And Brohm's going to get sacked for the first time. It is not Selby. Instead, it's Woody George.
Flag 2, Dave, came in late in the secondary. Maybe holding on South Florida on the receiver. Brian Brohm trying to get out and just gets taken to the ground by Woody George. This penalty's big.
Ooh, yep. It is against South Florida, Coach. Good eyes.
Holding. Number 27 on the defense against the receiver. 10-yard penalty from the line of scrimmage. Still second down.
So that's on Tyrone McKenzie. McKenzie, a transfer from Iowa State University. Of course, Dan McCarney, who used to be the head coach of the Cyclones, is here now.
Gee, he is such a good coach.
I agree.
Dan McCarney.
I agree.
He did a great job at Iowa
great
State.
Job.
Should not have gotten fired.
I agree.
And he brings so much emotion and enthusiasm to the sideline.
I would say this. You ADs out there that are looking for football coaches, keep that name in mind. Dan
I agree.
McCarney.
I'm with you.
Good run here by Bolin. 41-10 our score from Raymond James Stadium in Tampa, Florida. With Mike Gottfried and Melissa Knowles. I'm Dave Armstrong. Louisville, if they can win, and it's certainly a long way to go here, and we still believe maybe they need two wins, this one and the one against Rutgers next week at home, and of course, South Florida's already bowl eligible, trying to get into a better bowl. A win tonight, they could very well sneak into that top 25 again. And consider this, South Florida wasn't even ranked in the top 25 until this year. And they got all the way to number two.
Number two. They were sitting in great shape for the BCS game.
Number two is the unlucky number this year, though, isn't it, Coach?
No, it is. Brian Brown's thrown 28 passes right now, so he's creeping up on that 35.
He'll definitely get there.
Yeah. He may get to your above 45.
Oh, he's going north of that, I believe. Well, first and 10 here for Brown, past midfield. Bolin tripped up right at the line. Might have picked up a yard, and that's about it.
Can't run.
No.
He can't run the ball. And that's
not all on the running back.
No, it's not. It's the offensive line. It's no confidence in the run. And then you rely so much on the pass. You pass so much. You pass protected all the time. You're not firing off.
So second and nine. Brown back to the pass. And this one's complete. Oh. Slipping down on the play after making the grab, Harry Douglas. He tried to make a little more out of it. And now, because he went backward, he took away the first down. It's third and short.
He's fifth in the school's history book on pass reception. I think he's an outstanding wide receiver.
Yep. Missed a couple of games earlier this year with injury, and I think that cost Louisville at least one win, if not two.
Here's where you have prop now when you can't run the ball.
Well, they're going to blow this one dead.
Charge timeout. South Florida, what is the first charge timeout of the half?
Dave, when you can't run the ball on third down, you saw what they were going to do. They're going to roll out and throw the ball.
Jim Leavitt didn't like what they had called defensively. He calls the timeout from the sideline.
You're watching ESPN's Rivalry Week, presented by Remington.
Well, these two teams had played five times, or this was the fifth meeting between them, and two apiece in the rubber game of this match. This one is all South Florida, as they have a 41-10 lead. And joining us now, the Associate Commissioner of the Big East Conference, John Paquette. John, good to have you here. The Big East already has five teams bowl eligible, led by West Virginia at number five right now in the BCS.
We're the highest-ranked team in the BCS right now. They're playing Cincinnati tonight. I understand they're ahead.
Yes.
And, you know, certainly, I mean, everybody thinks about it after the Saturday of college football is over, who can jockey and who can move up. So we'll just have to wait and see. We still have some action tonight for some decisions to be made, games to be won, but we'll see.
That's a first down. Is Allen able to get the first down? You know, all right, so if West Virginia, and we'll just kind of play out the scenario, okay? I know you don't want to play this game, but we'll do it anyway. If they win tonight, and then, of course, they have the big showdown with UConn next week, there is still the possibility, I mean, the way things are going with Oklahoma losing tonight, You never know. West Virginia could still sneak back into that national title race.
You never know, and it's been one of those seasons, as you know, and the Big East has been really like the other leagues, Dave. You know, there's been surprises, and every time you think you know what's going to happen, something different happens. But certainly West Virginia right now is still in the mix.
How about South Florida? We see them tonight, impressive. They got all the way up to number two. Where do you expect them to go on? I know that's all a crystal ball right now, so a lot of things can happen.
A lot of things can happen, and obviously they've proven themselves to be a national program. They made it all the way up to number two, which seems to be the jinx spot, Mike, this year in the BCS. But certainly they have Jim Leavitt's done a great job here. They're going to end up in a good game. I guess you would expect me to say that because we have some good bowl deals, but they've certainly proven themselves on the national scene.
Dave, I wanted to ask John this question. If you get six teams eligible, you have five bowls, right?
Right.
What happens then?
Well, you have to try to make a deal for another team, although if that last team is 6-6, a 6-6 team can only go to a bowl where you have a deal with. So a 6-6 team in our league could only, quote, go to one of the, quote, Big East bowls, unless there's no other seven-win teams available in the nation, which is probably not going to happen.
So Louisville, for them, unless they get busy here in the second half, they're going to be sitting there in the nowhere land.
Well, that's possible, and certainly they have a big hill to climb. They climbed a pretty big hill in Morgantown last week. This one might be a little bit bigger.
You know, you look at the Big East now with South Florida, of course, added, Louisville added to this league. It's just phenomenal the way that the Big East, last year you guys went to five bowl games, won them all. The way you have jumped into the national landscape in football in just a very short period of time is truly amazing.
Well, we're happy this week. You know, this year we have eight teams in our league. We have six of them ranked at some point during the season. We have the emergence this year. We had Rutgers emerging as a national program last year. We have UConn this year, Cincinnati this year. We're really very happy with the way football's
happening. And South Florida ranked in the top 25 for the first time in their history this year. And we talked about it all night, about how they got all the way up to number two. South Florida looks like, too, this now is becoming a juggernaut. There are now four major teams in the state of Florida.
I think everybody knew that there was a lot of potential here. They have the right people in place. Obviously, Jim Leavitt's the right guy to get this done. And I don't think there's anyone who doesn't think that they're going to be very good for a long time.
I'm going to put you on the spot. Can I put him on the spot?
You can in 1 second. I just want to remind our viewers that the reason for the delay here on the field, they were reviewing the spot on the field. And now it is a fourth down. So the spot, it's not a first down for Louisville. They're facing a fourth down and less than a yard from the 40. Go ahead.
Got to go for it. John, I know we're going to go for this fourth down. Then I'm going to ask you about the IBM philosophy of the expansion.
Got it.
All right, here it is. Fourth down for Louisville. They're going to run for it, and they have it, and plenty, as Allen able to get the first down. He'll move the chains inside the 30. All right, it's on the spot.
Very fortunate that Ben Moffitt didn't make that play. Go ahead. Expansion.
When we brought these teams in, obviously a few years ago, we needed to add to our football membership. I think everyone saw the potential here at South Florida, which we just talked about. We also brought in Cincinnati and Louisville. UConn was just coming on the Division I scene, really. They've made tremendous strides in a short amount of period, or short period of time. Louisville, I think, was already pretty well established as a solid program. Cincinnati's really turned it around. And the other things that revolve around this that we really like is the attendance. The attendance here is tremendous. Cincinnati's selling out. Louisville has already been selling out. UConn is selling out. Rutgers has people on their season ticket waiting list. That's what we really like.
I'm going to send you to the political ring because you didn't answer. I'm looking for 12 teams.
Let's go back to the action, can we?
He's trying to add some more teams into this league. But I think, really, in this one to Allen, he's got another first down. If he hangs on to the ball, he does down to the 20-yard line. I think this league, more than any other league, has more of these almost rags-to-riches stories. When we've been to UConn, where they were in the trailers, and now they have this beautiful facility. We've been here to South Florida, where they were in the trailers, and now they have a beautiful football facility playing in a pro stadium. Louisville, you know, all the new facilities they have there. This is sort of that rags-to-riches football league with Rutgers coming onto the national scene. As you've been, this is really a success story for this Big East Conference.
And we're very happy with the speed that we've been able to, our teams have been able to accomplish this.
Fumble. And it looks for the moment that South Florida's got it. They do. Boy, another big hit. McKenzie, he comes in and strips the ball away.
Too early to say turn out the lights, but the switch is getting ready to be pulled here because when you're on this drive, can't run the ball. Brian Brown with the handoff, and Anthony Allen coughs it up.
Boy, what a special play there by Tyrone McKenzie out of the Big 12 from Iowa State. So it will belong to South Florida. They take over at their own 28-yard line. We're talking with John Paquette, who is the associate commissioner of the Big 12 Conference.
Let's make it the Big East.
Big East Conference, sorry. I was talking about the Big 12 with McKenzie and Iowa State. In the Big East, all right, look, we're going to show you the graphic, the bowl tie-ins, and there's the snapshot. The BCS bowl, of course, takes precedence. And is this the stepping stone? Is that how it goes in that order?
After the BCS, either Gator or Sun picks next.
Okay.
Yeah, then Meineke Car Care Bowl picks after that. Papa John's an international bowl. A lot of times we try to make the matchups that make the most sense for those two.
So, I was going to ask you. Go ahead, Dave.
No, I was just going to say, and you already have enough teams right now that are bowl eligible to fill those slots.
We have five with at least seven wins. The UConn's got nine. West Virginia and Cincinnati have eight right now.
Mm-hmm. What's the chances of getting two in the BCS?
This year, I don't see how you can discount anything, but right. Certainly we have a ways to go, at least this year, at least according to the standings this week, in terms of getting a second team.
When you want to run for president, I'm available for you. You're doing a great job.
I'll vote for both you guys, all right? You can run as his VP. They're going to air it out, and this pass incomplete, intended for Torres.
My last question, I promise, Dave.
No, go
UMass,
ahead.
UMass, Connecticut came on the scene, went from 1AA to 1. It just figures to me UMass should think about going to Division I and trying to get in the Big East.
I think I got this in an email last week, Dave. Mm-hmm. You know,
from him?
I don't know. We get a lot of emails. What Mike Trangisi, our commissioner, has always said is that if there's someone out there who can add value to our football membership, then we'll take a look at it. And obviously, we're only eight teams, and you know, we're the smallest BCS conference. Would it help in scheduling if we had somebody new? Well, it would, but we really want to add someone who's really going to add value to the league.
Do you see anybody that is now playing basketball in the Big East maybe stepping up to the plate and adding football?
We haven't heard anything along those lines. So I can't say really, Dave, that there's anything to report there. You know, there's always rumors out there, and you know, this is a nice topic for schools that play football. Sometimes, you know, fans and whoever like to get excited about it, but we don't think there's anything significant on the horizon.
Notre Dame may need a league, football wise.
He's look at him, no comment.
He's not
there.
Answering. No. He's not saying
Boy,
anything.
He's slick. I'm telling you, John. Thanks for joining us.
What's your slogan for the campaign?
Just say no.
Thank you.
ESPNU College Football Primetime presented by Citi is brought to you by eHarmony.com. Are you ready to fall in love? Here's downtown Tampa. The SunTrust building before the big game against West Virginia was actually lit up green. Melissa will have more on that a little bit later on. First and 10 for Brom. And this one's picked off.
Again, it was great coverage over there by Jenkins and then picked off, I think, by Gassette. Gassette, I think, is the guy that picked it off, but it was really Jenkins who made the play.
Yeah, Mike Jenkins just was sitting right in there and shows you why Todd McShay and Mel Kiper have him rated as a top corner. Breaks on the football, kicks the ball up there for the interception. Great coverage.
Great coverage. Again, Jenkins, who has a pick tonight. Remember, he lost his breath when he had that unbelievable interception in the end zone. And now he just took the breath away from Brom, who has now thrown three interceptions in this game. So let's go to Lowell Galindo and find out what's going on elsewhere. LG, what's up?
Well, the official word on Sam Bradford is he is out with a concussion, and things not going well for the Sooners as Aaron Crawford bangs it in from 3 yards out. Texas Tech up 34-10 in the third quarter. Steve Slayton getting into the mix for the West Virginia Mountaineers, a one-yard touchdown run, and West Virginia up on Cincinnati 28-17. Guys?
All right, 28-17 there for West Virginia. Coach, I'm going to play a little scenario for you. And this year in college football, it's dangerous, right? Because, yes. I mean, yeah, every week something goofy happens. But let's talk about the Big 12 for just a second. Yeah. Next week, you've got Missouri and Kansas. Two teams that are going to be in the top five, maybe the top three in the BCS. The winner of that one is going to go to the Big 12 championship game, where most likely they'll meet Oklahoma. If Oklahoma loses tonight, and they're well on their way, and they go ahead and beat either Kansas or Missouri in that Big 12 championship game, that allows a team like West Virginia or Ohio State to sneak back into the national title picture.
Or Arizona State.
There you
go. That's another one.
And this pass intended over here by Edwards. The Big 12, it looked like they were having their own little playoff. I mean, the scenario was there, figuring they would all win today, but with Oklahoma losing to Texas Tech, kind of throws a little bit into that plan. But Kansas and Missouri, they definitely took care of business. Kansas looked impressive again today against an Iowa State team. Missouri, and again, Chase Daniel, he really was the difference maker in that game today. And when you're a Heisman voter, you look for quarterbacks at this point in the season, or running backs or players that are really going to be difference makers. Well, here they go on fourth and eight, going for it. No. Grothy with a little pooch punt and a backward spin. So he shows a little versatility. We got a lot more to talk about. 4:18 remaining here in the third quarter. South Florida is still leading by 31. Same score as we had at halftime, 41-10 our score here from Raymond James Stadium in Tampa, Florida. Matt Grothy and the Bulls able to put this game away early. In fact, they've never trailed. They took the opening kickoff, and after Louisville fumbled the opening kickoff, they ran that in for a score, and they haven't looked back. Pass completed here by Brom as he's able to get it to Patrick Carter, who gets a first down up to the 27-yard line. Only 30 rushing yards for the Cardinals in this game tonight.
Can't run, and it all goes on Brian Brown's shoulders.
So now up to 32 pass attempts. He's back to 50%, but three picks. And I think he's had to just take more chances once his team got down so far. He's taking more chances downfield. That's creating more problems for Brom and for Kragthorpe and for the entire Cardinal team. Big hole, nice run by Stripling. And he's able to get up to the 37-yard line as we get you back to Lowell Galindo in the studio.
Hey, Dave, we're going to update you on Boston College and Clemson. James McCluskey is listed as a linebacker, but they put him in on offense. He gets the touchdown. They like to do that in Boston. Linebackers scoring touchdowns.
There you go. Not bad. They do it both with the Patriots.
Yep.
Well, it's a nice little play. Works. So that ACC championship up for grabs. Here's an end around.
And Douglas run out of bounds. He's able to pick up about five on that play.
Dave, I want to go back to what you said about Missouri and Kansas.
Yep.
I think Missouri sits in the best spot, and I'll tell you why. They beat Kansas, which they can.
Right.
They have already played Oklahoma.
Right.
Now, Oklahoma could, if Bradford's hurt, they got Oklahoma State next week, so they could get beat again. Texas would go in there then.
Ooh.
If they lose a couple more. But Missouri almost really played Oklahoma well and should have won the football game. Had some turnovers early, but a lot riding for Chase Daniel and Missouri's football.
My point is this, with regards to both Missouri and Kansas, and I'd love to get your opinion.
They got to win out.
If they win out, all right, not all the way to the championship game, but I'm saying Missouri or Kansas, either one, whoever comes out of the Arrowhead next week, then they win the Big 12 championship. I think one of those two teams should be number one in the country.
They'll be in.
Not just in the championship game, Coach. I think they should go in number one because of who they have beaten to get there. I mean, I think their strength of schedule will be better than anybody's. Nice little crossing route here. And again, it's Douglas. He's dancing around. He's right up at midfield, a little bit past midfield. He goes to the 45. Nice play again by Douglas.
You know, what you got to do if you're Louisville right now, you got to claw your way slowly back into this thing. You can't worry about the clock. You can't worry about the score. Just make things happen. If you get a score, then you start to speed it up a little bit, but you have to claw yourself back in this thing.
A good night for Douglas. Kragthorpe, though, not a good night for the Cardinals. So disappointed with the way his team really unraveled for them in that first half. A lot of penalties, and now we've got a sack. Second time that Brohm has been sacked, and this time it's Jared Bowie. Bowie with his first sack. So they're doing a good job on Selby. No sacks for Selby, but Bowie with a sack there.
Dan McCarney's the guy that coaches this defensive line. He's got the green shirt on. He just put his hand to his head. He really can coach this defense. He told me before the game he has better talent right here than he had at Iowa State. He's an enthusiastic guy. You love to play for him.
And a penalty flag comes into the backfield. Pass intended there for Carter. There is Dan McCarney. Did a tremendous job at a tough place to coach, Iowa State. Had his fair share of success in one of the games that's important to them.
Holding. Number 68 offense. Kelly's declined.
And that's, of course, the game against Iowa every year.
Right. It's hard for a guy that's been the head coach to go back as an assistant, but he doesn't seem to have any problem with it. You have to forget you were the head coach. You have to work like a regular assistant.
Well,
he said, Coach, I
could have sat out. You know, he had a buyout in his contract from Iowa State, but he said, I love being around kids.
Yeah.
I want to coach. Third and 14 here for Brohm. They need to get it down to the 34. Brohm given time. This will be short of the first down marker, but he gets some back.
Gotta go for it.
Okay, Barnage with the catch.
Barnage, when he came off the line of scrimmage, looked like the linebacker was holding him in no call. But Barnage curled up, got to completion to make a fourth and reasonable to go for it.
They are going to go for it here on fourth and six. They're one for one so far tonight on fourth down. For the year, they are now 7 of 13. They were 6 of 12 coming into tonight. And he wants more than the first down. Well, kind of cutting the route off too early was Trent Guy. He stopped. And then the ball sailed up over his head.
That was a good job of coaching by South Florida. But And that's not a bunch of bull I'm giving you, because they played the crossing route. I watched their linebackers. They played the crossing route. They knew what Louisville was going to go to.
Yeah, three interceptions. Special plays on defense. Mike Jenkins has been extremely tough. They forced fumbles. That was a tremendous play there by McKenzie. And then there again, Jenkins. So South Florida takes over on downs. This pass completed to Mitchell. And McCarney continues to coach that defensive line over on that sideline. Even in a 41-10 game, still looking at this as a coaching moment.
He's teaching. He's teaching. He's encouraging. He's, you know, just there for the players to build on.
That'll be close to a first down run there by Ford. That is a first down.
Doug Woolard was with him. I saw him back here. Fine AD for South Florida. He had Del Blue with him, who's their number one booster here. And it's his birthday tonight. But Doug Woolard has done a very good job here for the South Florida program.
Could be the last play of this third quarter. That pass is completed. It'll be another first down. They'll stop the clock briefly to move the chains. But they get it to Jesse Hester Jr. That's his second grab. That one goes for 14 yards. They'll restart the clock once they move the chains, and that'll do it for the end of the third quarter. Hester, everybody thought he'd go to Florida State where his dad played, but they didn't really do a good job in recruiting him. And you know, Jesse Sr. stayed out of the recruiting process. He said, I wanted my son to go where he wanted to go and where he felt comfortable, and he felt comfortable coming here.
Can I say this?
Yes.
That was a mistake.
It was. So all smiles here at South Florida as they lead by 31 going to the fourth quarter. Easy button. They've been pushing it tonight often for South Florida. I need to get one of those easy buttons, Coach.
I'd like to have one myself.
South Florida keeps it on the ground. Get that clock moving. That's Ford as he goes down to the 31-yard line. I was thinking 2 years ago, South Florida won by 31, 45-14. Right now they lead by 31. I would say they have had a huge edge against Louisville at home the last couple of times.
Yeah, Jim Leavitt's got to be happy with the performance of his football team through three quarters.
Ford again. And just across the 30 to the 29 as we get you back to Lowell Galindo for another update.
All right, we're starting in the ACC with Clemson and Boston College. Watch Cullen Harper for the Tigers. He's going to try to hurdle everyone on this play. Little ugly, but it works for the touchdown. Tigers leading by four with 5 minutes left in the fourth. And West Virginia trying to hold off Cincinnati. Bradley Glathar scores for Cincinnati. West Virginia still up by five with 2.5 left to play.
All right, boy, it's getting a little tighter there in Cincinnati. Fans, they're getting able to go a little bit crazy. And this pass is caught. Another completion as they get it to Jason Sherman, who makes the grab.
Jason Sherman with a good throw by Matt Grothy. They got some receivers. You always expect the Florida teams to have good receivers. So much speed in the high schools.
Sherman has eschewed the Mohawk look that
has
so prevalent here at South Florida.
Unless he's got a wig.
Ford looking for a block. Gets it down to the 11. A little extracurricular going on. Jim Leavitt just pacing that sideline. That's a man in motion, isn't it?
Yeah, he is.
He is in constant motion. Does sprints before the game. And told us the reason he does it, he said, my motor just gets going, so I got to do it just to calm myself down a little bit.
He's out of the box right now. He's too far down.
He's wandering down toward the 20-yard line. Just pacing the sideline. Second and eight.
His stomach's rolling over right now.
Mm-hmm. And there's another touchdown for Ford, his second of the night. 140 yards on 24 carries and two touchdowns. What a night. So Leavitt able to pace his way in. Carney, you can see him looking at his defensive front line saying, all right, our turn next. They're continuing to coach even though they lead here 47-10. They're treating this as if it's a close game. So for Louisville, they've got one game next week against Rutgers. That's going to be at home, and for them, coach, you know, they probably are thinking, all right, we can be bowl eligible by winning that one, but as we heard from John Paquette, it's going to be an uphill climb for the Cardinals to get into a bowl game with only six wins. And the tempers are flaring just a little bit, and the officials do a good job to separate the players. And Kragthorpe has had that scowl on his face for much of this season. Ford able to run in for yet another touchdown for the Bulls. Beautiful downtown Tampa, Florida. And what a gorgeous weekend weather-wise. One of those buildings in there is the SunTrust building. Melissa will tell you more about that in a second. South Florida leads this 48-10. That scowl has been permanently etched into the face of Steve Kragthorpe this year. And certainly here tonight, he is not very pleased with the way his team has performed here tonight by any stretch of the imagination. Powell, nice little hole. Powell stays on his feet, a little straight arm action. And he goes out of bounds at the 46-yard line. Let's go down to Melissa Knowles. Melissa?
You know, we've watched Coach Leavitt pace back and forth during the game today, but you know, that's not the only time that you'll find him pacing. He told us the other day that before the West Virginia game, he was walking around outside his hotel until about 1 in the morning, until he saw the SunTrust building downtown that was lit up in green. And when he saw that, he said, you know what? Everybody's pulling for us. I think I can go ahead and go to bed. Dave?
Okay. How about that? I mean, that ended up being a marquee moment for this program that went over West Virginia, and then they followed it with a few more, got to number two in the country, and then three losses in a row by a total of 15 points.
Yeah, all of a sudden Louisville making a switch, bringing Hunter Cantwell at quarterback. Brian Brown was 18 for 37 for 213 yards.
So he got over 35 again, 35 tosses on the night, for the eighth time in 11 games this year. And this play unravels here as Cantwell, I don't think he ever found the handle on the snap.
Maybe a South Florida's ball. And new quarterback in, new cadence.
They're in there trying to unravel
bodies. South Florida's got this ball.
They do too, they do. They do. One more thing that goes wrong. One more scowl.
Hunter Cantwell calling the cadence. The ball never gets up. Eric Wood, center, And Terrell McLean recovers the football.
Look at that. Six turnovers for South Florida.
Louisville, six. And South Florida, the three games they lost 11 turnovers. So when they don't turn the football over, they win.
And now Grant Gregory in for the Bulls, taking over for Grothy. Lowell Galindo, no subbing for him, baby. He's still working hard in the studio, Lowell.
Oh, buddy, enjoy. I really do. Clemson, though, they're going to need to come back if they want to beat Boston College, because Matt Ryan rolling out and finding Rich Gannell for the touchdown. Ryan's seventh 300-yard game of the season. BC up by three with a 1:38 to play.
So BC, you know, Clemson, they're one of those teams that a lot of people say they win a lot of games, but when it comes down to crunch time, they don't. And that's probably an unfair criticism of Clemson, because they've had a lot of success under Tommy Bowden there. Flags coming in. Stop the clock with 10:55 to go. Again, both teams have gone to their second string quarterbacks.
Hold it. Number 30 off. 10-yard penalty for the spot of the infraction. Still second down.
Infraction against Benjamin Williams. So here is Grant Gregory, a junior out of Athens, Ohio.
When you talk about quarterbacks, Owen, I know there's a buck and change left in that game. Cullen Harper, the Clemson quarterback, has been on fire. So he may lead him back yet.
Yep.
I wouldn't put the nail in the coffin yet. I know you don't. You're with
him. In this one, I will.
Yeah, this is.
In this one, I will.
Pick up to him those. Because Church is over here. Been over.
Well, they're still singing a few last verses of Just As I Am.
A lot of people left early.
Few people are ready to go home. Pot roast is cooking in the oven.
I tell you, the only people left are the organist and the preacher.
When you were a kid, I don't know if it was like this for you, but just coming home from church on Sunday and that roast was cooking. And
smelled
you got
good,
home, it
yeah.
Smelled great walking in the door. Man. Third
you
18.
You hungry?
Kind of. Somehow I don't think there's a pot roast waiting for me in the hotel. What a catch. A throw on target, but the catch absolutely spectacular by Dontavia Bogan. 23 yards.
Dontavia Bogan, freshman, 6'1", 180. Good concentration, bringing it in. Thomasville, Georgia.
Good catch. Nice throw, too. So that moves the chains down to the 38. Clock moving, nearing the 10-minute mark.
The L train's got some work to do, because Clemson game and Cincinnati and West Virginia, a lot of things happening out there.
Hand off here is to Williams. Very little game. All right, West Virginia winning tonight. That final now in as West Virginia wins. So they go to 4-1 in the conference. UConn and West Virginia next Saturday at West Virginia for the conference championship.
Here's the good thing about West Virginia. They still have two games left. Ohio State's done. I think Ohio State will pass them tomorrow, but then I think West Virginia, with the two games left, can pass Ohio State back again.
Yeah, they'll get a lot of bonus points if they can beat UConn next week.
Big, and so they're sitting right there, pretty good shape with Oklahoma behind right now. I don't know what the updated score is.
Woodney Terrain gets up a little bit hobbled, but he's going to stay in the game, at least for now. I think they're going to get him out of there. So Woodney comes out. And a 3rd and 8. Gregory, little blitz, and they're going to sack him. So So good play defensively there for Louisville.
You know, there's a lot of people right now out there watching, saying, why are they throwing?
Yeah.
But you know what? You have to play your second quarterback, Grant Gregory. You got to make sure he gets some live work because you're one play away. When you have Matt Grothy and he runs the ball like he does, he could get hurt at any time. So you have to have your second guy
ready.
So
Kragthorpe on the other sideline, he's not upset about that because he understands what's going on.
Hey, this night has been so bad. Yeah. What else could upset you?
He can't be upset with anything South Florida has done. He's got enough upset in him with his own team.
His football team tonight laid an egg. And again, he's the right guy for this job. I believe he'll have Louisville right up there in the top 20 in the next year, in the next couple years, because he's got Cantwell coming back. But his players did not come to play tonight. Now, you could say, that's a coach's job. Hey, you practice them, you coach them, and all of a sudden they come out here and started with the first kickoff. Everything went wrong.
High punt. Great hang time and a fair catch. 8:24 remaining in this. We'll take a break. I've got another great question for you, Coach.
Okay, great.
Back,
I'm right? looking forward
all right.
to it.
Okay. A23 left here. You are looking at an aerial shot of Raymond James Stadium in Tampa, Florida, and it is all South Florida tonight. College basketball on the U continues tomorrow. A couple of games from the O'Reilly Auto Parts. Puerto Rico tip-off at 11 a.m. Temple faces Marist in a seventh-place game. Then at 1 Eastern, the College of Charleston takes on Houston in the fifth-place game, all coming to you from Puerto Rico.
Good tournament down there. They got great teams.
First and 10 again. Hunter Cantwell in for Brom. And the give here is to Powell. He's a pretty good looking back as he gets it up to the 20. All right, you ready for your question?
Yes.
You were talking about Kragthorpe earlier, taking over a team that only had one loss last year. Your opinion, tougher to take over a team that has won or tougher to take over a team that has lost?
A losing team?
Yes.
A losing team because the habits are bad. The selfishness is there when you lose. Nobody wants to be the father of a loss. And so you have a lot of people pointing fingers. But when you take over a team that's 12-1, and you come in with a different philosophy, sometimes the guys are not going to do what they're supposed to do.
Yep.
I don't know any of this,
right.
But I know this. It's tough. All of a sudden, you got some guys that maybe are not going to class, or you got some guys, and you set down your laws, and some guys bolt and don't want to be a part of that. I go back to what Patrick Carter said, the wide receiver. He said, the chemistry is not as good this year on this team as it was last year. I don't know the reason for that. So the players have to take a lot of the responsibility. And I'm going to finish with this. When you lose four games by 7 or less points, you didn't find a way to win. The coach's job is to get you with a chance to win the game at the buzzer. And so you lost four games, less than 7 points. You didn't make plays.
Very good. So in that, your final answer is tougher to take on a job, or it's tough either way. It really is, isn't it? Because in one case, your first year is your toughest because you're changing a mindset.
Right.
And if they've lost, you've got to get them to rebuild the wheel.
Yeah.
If they've won, you've got to convince them that your way is still a winning way.
Right. I'll give you an example. Ron Zook, I was with him the night at Penn State, beat him 66-3, whatever it was. And as I did that game, I watched him on the sideline. I thought to myself, I bet he's thinking, if I can just go out and get my own players and bring them in here, and they'll play hard and we'll win someday. Mm-hmm. So that's what's going through Steve Frakesart's mind right now is, hey, I got to recruit. I got to get some guys that are going to buy into what I want to do here, and we'll be all right. Louisville's going to win. They're going to win soon.
Chris Robinson, the injured player, while they're tending to him. Let's get a quick update from Lowell Galindo.
Well, the Clemson-Boston College game came down to the leg of Mark Buchholz trying to kick a 54-yarder for the win. Career-long 52. Needed a couple of feet on this one. No good. Boston College holds on to win the ball game, and they win the ACC Atlantic. West Virginia also beating Cincinnati, and Texas Tech sticking it to Oklahoma 34-13 with 12 minutes left in the fourth quarter.
All right, so West Virginia, UConn all set up for next week. Oklahoma now with a loss there. Now they really have to beat Oklahoma State next week in their regular season finale. That's that old Bedlam series between the Sooners and the Cowboys.
I'll give you another stat. Matt Ryan's probably back in the Heisman.
Another pick. That's the fourth interception for South Florida here tonight. And this one picked off by Jerome Murphy.
You wonder when you watch South Florida, how'd they lose three straight games? I'll tell you the answer to that. It's in a mayonnaise jar on Funkelwagle Square. No, they had 11 turnovers in three games.
Oh,
that's why they lost those games.
Well, tonight, Kragthorpe's team has turned it over now seven times. Only that one turnover for South Florida. They had one interception. That's it. So a plus six, that's going to win on almost any night. There have been times, though, South Florida, even against Auburn earlier, they had all those turnovers. They didn't take advantage of that. They did win the game, but they didn't put it away. Tonight, they've taken advantage of the turnovers. And that'll be a tackle for a loss. Good play defensively there by Hayden.
Hand off to Benjamin Williams.
Benjamin Williams goes backwards.
How would you rate the top five tomorrow?
Well, I would go LSU.
I would, too.
Kansas.
Kansas, too.
Missouri.
I would go West Virginia 3.
Then I would go West Virginia 4.
Okay. I'd go Missouri 4.
Okay. And then probably Ohio State 5.
I would do Arizona State 5.
Okay. That's good. I don't think, you know, there's going to be a big argument either way on any
charge
of that.
Charge timeout, Louisville. That is the first charge timeout of the half.
Well, when you look at South Florida's season this year, you know, it starts with a bang. Tremendous play here to Hester into the end zone. That's in overtime to beat Auburn by 3. And then West Virginia comes to town. Another special play there as they're able to get it to Mitchell. They go all the way up to number 2 in the country. And then a fake here as Rutgers comes through with a big win, 30-27. Jim Leavitt's team losing for the first time. And then they lose again as they turn the ball over and over and over and over against Connecticut in that contest. They wound up losing 3 straight games. They lost to Rutgers, UConn, and Cincinnati in back-to-back weeks. Back-to-back-to-back weeks. Well, a completion and a recovery for a touchdown. The touchdown, it'll be credited to Bogan, the freshman. It was Love who had possession. I'll probably review this.
Good throw. Let's see if Love's got it.
Yeah, he had it. And then it fumbles into the end zone, and that's where Bogan picks it up. I think he had it. Look. Catch. He's got it. Makes a move. Knocked out.
Just to argue, I'm going to say he didn't have it.
Okay.
Let's see, but you know, at the score 54-10, what does it matter?
I mean, even when Louisville makes a play to knock a ball free, it still doesn't work out for him.
No, it's right there. Bogan's ready to recover.
They're reviewing this play officially upstairs.
I think Louisville next week.
Play stands is called on the field.
You were right.
Touchdown, South Florida.
I'm not arguing with you.
Okay. Louisville will beat Rutgers next week. As bad as they're playing right here, they're going to rally for the last game at home. And they should beat Rutgers to get to 6-6. This is bottom out time. We're bottom out.
Yep.
You can't go any lower than this. 55-10.
Yeah, that's pretty low. You know, and again, it started with the opening kickoff, and it never got any better for Louisville. It got a lot better for South Florida. 7 minutes to go. ESPNU College Football Primetime presented by Citi. Whatever your story is, your Citi card can help you write it. Citi, let's get it done. And by Clean Exchange, the only electric shaver with a disposable head. Clean Exchange, new from Remington. With Mike Gottfried and Melissa Knowles, I'm Dave Armstrong. I haven't heard from Melissa in a while.
She's gone.
She's gone. She got some new boots, and those boots were made for walking. Short kickoff here. Taken at the 20 by Powell. Trying to bust outside. Now we got a flag. Why not? That's the 843rd flag of this game. All right, Coach, you had a top 10 going into today.
Yeah, I still like LSU 1, Kansas 2, West Virginia, Oklahoma, out there, Missouri move up.
Bump them
Arizona
up.
State, Ohio okay. State up.
Okay.
Oregon, I don't know, Georgia up, Clemson out, Virginia Tech in.
Okay.
It's been one of those kind of years.
It really has.
If you would have told a guy, froze a guy before the year and brought him out and said, okay, tell us who you're going to be in your top 10. He'd had Michigan 5. Froze him and then brought him here at this day and said, okay, here's who's in here. He'd say Kansas and Missouri. You'd have to freeze him again. But if,
I love how you think. Big run here. It's Powell. He's been one of the most impressive of the Cardinals here tonight. He has not quit one bit.
How about if you
freeze him? 34 yards on that carry.
Uh-huh.
Well, there have been 9 unranked teams this year that have beaten top 5 teams. That's never happened in college football before.
Biggest upset of the year,
Appalachian State. And I was there last week. It was awesome. Missed
That's
you.
That's a great place.
Sorry you weren't there. And it was tremendous. What a great atmosphere in little Boone, North Carolina, up in the mountains.
You know, another big
upset. We're
going
there next year. You and I are going there next year.
I'd love to go back.
What does he have written on the back of his head? Family. For Alvarado.
You want me to sing that? We are family?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. I need a orchestra
with
it.
Freeze that hairdo.
It was froze. Don Eagle had a long.
Clock can't move fast enough. 5:39. Don't forget basketball coming up Sunday night. The number one team in the country. And you can see them on the U. On the U, folks. It's North Carolina, Roy Williams and those Tar Heels against the Iona Gaels. College basketball Sunday night at 6 Eastern. They're one of those favorites to win it all. They're very good, Coach. Very good. North Carolina. Oh, there. How about that? Powell. Good for him. Good for him. I like the way he's played this whole game.
He's played his heart off.
30-yard touchdown run. Good for him.
When he went in on the kickoff after the first fumble, he made some moves in the kickoff receiving team, and then he takes this ball in for the touchdown. Just shows good strength and power as he gets to the outside and makes a little move there, not to be denied.
A little subtle thing, too. He was able to switch the ball from one hand to the other. I mean, that shows some savvy. And the extra point, that is good by Carmody.
And that's what you're looking for if you're Steve Kragthorpe and this coaching staff. You're looking for the guys that are going to give you the effort.
Carmody, by the way, 5 points tonight, which leaves him just 2 points shy of the most points in NCAA history. You know who has the record?
Artem Manek.
No.
No, I mean, he's called Artem Manek.
How about now? Can you guess?
I'm going to say Roman Anderson.
Good guess. It's good stuff. Roman Anderson from Houston.
I was froze at the beginning of the speech.
All right. Right now, the big thing in college football is the spread offense, right? Everybody's doing the spread. Is that sort of a variation of the run and shoot that Houston used to run?
A little bit. It's really like the option play, the wishbone, because with the wishbone, you isolate people and you're able to take inferior people and play against people that are superior to you. Now you take the spread and you spread everybody out, so you get all those strong, fast guys moving in space, so you equalize a superior team again.
Are we seeing less and less in college football where we're going to see quarterbacks like Brom, that traditional drop-back quarterback, and more dual-threat quarterbacks like we're seeing from Grothy?
No, I think you'll still see some spread guys where you can throw the football, spread them out. He's okay. Not going to be a runner like Brom is, but if you do have a running quarterback that can throw, you have a double threat.
Right.
Matt Grothy being a great example. He can throw, but he can run.
It's been a real laugh fest.
And he can laugh.
Yeah. He can start a Mohawk craze. 40 guys on this team with the Mohawk. So there was that one barber in Tampa who has specialized in the Mohawk. And for years and years, his barber chair sat unused. Now all of a sudden, it's packed.
Do you know who was the first guy with the Mohawk?
Well, Chief something. I don't know.
I don't know. No. I want to rephrase that question.
All right.
First athlete.
John Riggins.
No. Don Eagle. He was a wrestler. He had the Mohawk.
Really?
Little knowledge.
Okay, there you go. That was good. That was unique. I don't think if they were trying to run a trick play, it only
tricked Mike
Jenkins.
No, he's just trying to run that clock.
Okay.
That young man's going to have a lot of money here real soon. Mike Jenkins.
Oh, yeah.
He's going to be bankers are going to be looking for him.
He's
lawyers.
Special, special cornerback. Now Gregory out. So we're going to third string quarterback now. Anthony Severino is now in there. Severino, a senior. A chance for Severino to get some PT.
I'll give you another question. Who's the coach of the year right now, and who makes it at season's end?
Right now, it's Mangino.
Okay.
Right now, I would say Mark Mangino's got to be the coach of the year. No one expected Kansas.
Right.
No one expected Kansas.
I agree so far.
I would. Well, I don't know. After that, I'd have to give it some thought. What do you think? Fumble.
I'm going to say Gary Pinkel could be the coach of the year.
Yep. I think he could too. Gary Pinkel, of course, from Missouri.
Jeff Jagodzinski's had a good year, BC in his first year.
Well, let's go to Lowell Galindo, who's our coach of the year.
As always, guys, as always, I do what I can. Texas Tech, however, they cannot go to sleep.
is Oklahoma coming back. Joey Hazel doing the damage at quarterback. Emmanuel Johnson, who completely beats that Texas Tech secondary. 65 yards for the touchdown, and with 7:50 left, OU within 14.
Man, don't count the Sooners out of that one just yet. If they win tonight, they wrap up the South, and then they play the winner of the Kansas-Missouri game, which happens next Saturday at Arrowhead Stadium. By the way, that is a home game for the Jayhawks, but Lou Perkins, their athletic director, he decided to try a two-year experiment and play that game at Arrowhead. It'll be at Arrowhead this year, and then next year when Missouri would have had the home game, they'll play it at Arrowhead again. And then they'll go from there and see if that's something that's doable. But who would have thought, honestly, Coach, you've been around that Kansas City area, who would have thought that a game between Kansas and Missouri 6 months ago or whatever would be the biggest sporting event at Arrowhead Stadium, not only this year, but for many, many years?
I'd like to have a bunch of tickets to that game that's got to be a tough ticket.
Do you still get the sense, you coached at Kansas, do you still get the sense that there are still some non-believers about the Jayhawks?
No respect. They're going to look at everything and say, okay, they played a soft non-league schedule, and they have, you know, they beat some good teams, but they haven't beat a must win. Now, Missouri could be that game if they beat Missouri.
Yeah.
And then Oklahoma could be added on to that.
I mean, with Kansas, you look at them and you say, okay, maybe their schedule, they got lucky. They didn't have to play Oklahoma. They didn't have to play Texas this year. I mean, in the Big 12, you don't play everybody every year. So this year they got lucky. The schedule worked out for them. They didn't have to play those two teams. But you can't deny this. Every game the Jayhawks have been in, they have dominated those games. Yeah. It hasn't even been close. They haven't had a close game all season long.
No, and when you look in Missouri, too, I think Kansas is really good. And I think Mark Mangino has done a great job. Not a good job, a great job.
I agree.
Getting winning then. But Missouri, when you look at Missouri, they beat Illinois. They went to the SEC and beat Ole Miss. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they beat Nebraska,
almost beat
Texas
Oklahoma.
Tech, Colorado A&M, and today Kansas State.
Yep.
So they have a lot to play for. I mean, that's going to be the most anticipated football game next weekend.
Yeah, most anticipated this year.
This year.
Of college football.
I think so.
And I think, though, that still there are those people who are just kind of waiting for Kansas to lose to say, see, I told you they weren't very good.
Well, they've had to wait for about 10 weeks.
11 now.
Yeah.
11 and 0. I mean, this the last time that the Jayhawks were this deep into a season undefeated, 1909. They finished the year 9-0.
I think it's fabulous for the alumni and the university and the fans because they've waited for this for a long time.
By the way, they're the only school in the country, too, with their two men's programs both in the top five, the Jayhawk basketball team is ranked number 4 in the country right now, and now it'll be number 2 for Kansas for football.
When I was a Kansas football coach, when we got ready to play Missouri the first year I was there, everybody told me all the stories about how the people came in from Missouri and burned down the town. So there's a lot of dislike for Missouri.
Oh, boy.
Missouri probably said Kansas burnt their town.
And you know what's great, too? You know the geography there. Kansas City divided by that state line. So half the city lives in Missouri, half lives in Kansas. So you just add all of that to the mix.
Great.
Next Saturday is going to be unbelievable at Arrowhead.
What's at stake? A chance to play in the championship game and a chance for the Heisman Trophy guy to come out of that game.
Yeah, you're right.
Not without doubt.
Could be Reesing.
Yeah, it could be.
Could be Chase Daniels. Could be Reesing, the quarterback for the Jayhawks. All right, what's left for these teams? Louisville, do they just play out the string against Rutgers next week? And then for South Florida, they have the game at Pittsburgh next week. Going to be favored in that game. Wanstead's team, though, they almost pulled off an upset today.
You almost beaten Rutgers.
Yep. They only lost by, what, four? No. So the Cardinals know that going to 5-6 after tonight, the only chance they have of being in a bowl game is to win against Rutgers next week. No easy task. But that's their only chance. I agree with you, though, Coach. I think they're going to circle the wagons.
Oh, they're going to circle the wagons. I wouldn't want to be Rutgers coming in there after this. This has been a...
And how about South Florida? They've righted the ship. Three straight losses. You know, they could have gone totally in the tank. A win last week against Syracuse, and then they dominate Louisville here tonight.
I think they have their eye on the Sun Bowl. And if they can win at Pittsburgh next week, they could be in a position to get that Sun Bowl bid. All the backups in for South Florida.
Howell with the catch. Clock moving under a minute now before they snap it again. This is at the 20.
I think it was pretty nice that you got your buddy to get the blimp here tonight for the blimp shots.
Yeah. I just got that taken care of. It's good to see Peter again, our crack statistician. I mean, the poor guy, he's on vacation with his wife, and he's called into duty.
Hey, Peter's living the dream.
Yep. Aren't we all? Pass completed. I think Louisville somehow, they just want to get one more score. Patrick Carter's got that. Well, Coach, you've got to be impressed with South Florida here tonight.
Really am. The speed, the toughness, growthy defensive secondary, and Mike Jenkins, Selby, I mean, then they got it all.
Yeah, they really
do. You could see where they were ranked high.
Into the end zone, and no, not into the end zone. A little bit shy of the end zone. The pass is caught by Kuhn, but at the 1 yard line. And I don't think they're going to run another play. They're going to call timeout.
Call the timeout.
Oh boy.
I think they're trying to get Hunter Campbell from Paducah, Kentucky to score here. He'll be the quarterback in the future. Played well when Brown was hurt.
Yeah, he did last year. Sub for him and did well.
Here's the thing a lot of people forget. You look at that Louisville sideline, they got to go home yet.
Whoa.
Yeah, I mean, they got a trip.
That is a long
and
ride back.
You guys are bumped up and bruised and grouchy, and coaches are grouchy, and stewardesses are not going to like their flight tonight.
Well, don't forget, coming up, it's Sports Center U next with the L Train, Lowell Galindo, Tom Luganville. They'll kind of recap the entire day of college football.
Those guys are good.
Yes, they are. You'll join them Monday for Inside the Polls. Great show. Powell knocked for a loss.
We're going to call another timeout.
They do. 2 seconds to go. Three seconds to go. Crowd doesn't like it. I don't think Kragthorpe likes it, but
no,
he wants to work on something.
Yeah, he's working on his quarterback, but a surprise to the play before, but I believe they'll throw this football. They cannot run.
No.
They can't run the ball.
You and I will be in Syracuse next week.
Syracuse.
Cincinnati at Syracuse.
Bring your long johns. It'll be cold. Hey, another upset today. Here. How about Louisiana Monroe beating Alabama?
Yeah. The band's still into it. Somebody put another quarter in the jukebox up there. Cantwell to throw it. And it's tipped incomplete, and that will do it. This one is in the books. It's a dominating performance by the Bulls here tonight. So Leavitt's team coach, they came to play, and they put it away with a 41-10 advantage at the half.
From the start, they dominated this football game.
So once again, our final score, South Florida wins this one 55-17. Coming up next, we send you to our Sports Center U studio with Lowell Galindo and Tom Luganville. For more information, log on to your home for the finest in college sports, ESPNU.com. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Mike Gottfried and Melissa Knowles and our entire crew here in Tampa, Dave Armstrong saying so long, everyone.